Okay, we are live. We can start now.
Good evening, all. This is Chandra Mohan, orthopedic physiotherapist from Dindivanam Sri Samaraj Physiotherapy Center. A warm welcome to all the participants from our nation and abroad, and fitness and rehab YouTube channel subscribers for the EXRX India presenting Sri Samaraj Health Services Private Limited, an attempt to work world record events, webinar Super League session 14. In association with Sri Samaraj Physiotherapy Center, Pre-Kill Studio, Chennai, Soyram Academy, Chennai, and Physio Active Wellness Hub from Gurugram. Today's topic is physiotherapist's role and outcome measures in ICU will be taken by one of my professors. I'm proud of him, Dr. Shankar Kanesh, MPT Cardio, ICU in charge, St. John's Medical College, St. John's National Academy of Health Sciences, Bangalore. I also welcome our volunteer and AEXRX team members, Duna Saha and Dr. Rupesh. Now, I request our resource person, Dr. Shankar Kanesh, to start the session.
Okay. Shall I start, sir?
Yes, yes.
Okay, sir. Thank you for the introduction, sir. And you are doing a very great job during this COVID period time. It was an amazing effort. I'm very happy to part of this. And once again, I congratulations to whole team, Rupesh and others, Dona ma'am, all. It is doing very good effort. And about myself, as I am a cardiopulmonary critical care physiotherapist. Till the date, I am working on the ICU. About almost 7-8 years, around 8 years, I have the experience in the critical care physiotherapist. So about my experience, I got a lot of gratifications, happiness, and joyful and proud to be a critical care physiotherapist. The reason began is in cardiopulmonary physical therapy is a evidence-based practice. Because when I'm going to see all patients, because there is no, this is my patient, or because all intensive care patients, even the patient in the room are to till the ventilator support, I'm taking it as my patients. Usually I'm going to the ICU, I will see on the patient chest. First I will start with the patient chest. I'll used to auscultate that. I'll heard some abnormal sound like a crackles, rattles, wheeze, whatever that abnormal sounds. Immediately I work on them. So what happened after the after the few therapy sessions, like for effective physiotherapy sessions, for after that I will start to auscultate. So immediately that noise will be very beautiful. That sounds will be what I heard, the crepitation, crackles, everything will be immediately after the post therapy session. It is a very very beautiful, and it is giving for me a more confident and feedback mechanism to improve myself. And moreover, I am the one of the person to Rupesh, can you change the slide? Okay. So I am the one of the, okay.
Sir, if you click on that, you can start changing the slide, sir.
Okay. It is not moving. Okay,
sir, I will handle, sir. You just say me next, I will just go to the next.
You go to previous.
Sir, you can use the arrow keys from your keyboard too.
Okay.
Or the mouse pointer.
Yes. Go to the previous one. Okay, so now you come to the next one, next slide. Now you can state it. So I am very proud to be said, because it is, I told you, for evidence-based practice. Whenever I am doing that, I told you the pre-physiotherapy, after the physiotherapy, I will auscultate, all the sounds become very beautiful. You know? So what happened? I am very happy to see the changes of the next slide. See the ABG in PO2. ABG in the PO2. Next slide.
Rupesh.
Rupesh, please help me.
Yeah, I changed it.
PO2. And next.
thing, it takes time to load actually.
Because, and next I will be one of the person to, one by one, I'm only the one of the person to minimize the oxygen consumption, as well as I'm one of the reason for beginning the patient weaning from the mechanically ventilated, as well as next one. So finally, if I'm showing the serial chest x-ray, whatever that's right, seeing the beautiful chest x-ray after the post for physiotherapy session for 1 or 2 days, I can see the next slide. I can see the beautiful, the chest x-ray. So this is the things before I will, this all changes the PO2 level in the ABG and minimizing oxygen consumption of the patient and the changes in the mode of the mechanical ventilation. I am the one of the person for weaning from the ventilator, as well as improve the patient chest x-ray. I am very proud to be it is done by only cardiopulmonary physical therapist, and it will be giving more feedback mechanism to improve myself. Next slides. So now I'm going to my topic is actually, go to the title of the Parupesh title. My topic is actually PT role and outcome measures in the ICU. What is that? The measure, the worth of physical therapy. I want to know how many people are you for every day in routine practice you are using the outcome measures. Can you put it in the chat box? I can see your routine practice, especially for the ICU, those who are going to ICU, you can put it on the, what are the outcome measures you are using in the ICU? Okay, sir, that's what I want to make to next slide, which will be helpful. What are the things? Next, you go to the third slide.
Someone is answering SPO2, pulse rate.
That is under physiological parameters. Physiological, that is under immediately for the monitor parameter. I am talking to about that mainly the functional outcome to the everyday. It is you for immediately, you can see the for immediately the patients after the therapy. But I'm going to take that one by one, that for outcome measures. So before that, PT role. What is the PT role? Before, I want to know what is the reason for the ICU admission. Reason for the ICU admission, because whenever I'm asking my students what is intensive care, what is ICU means, they will tell different definition, where the reference also, because they're making own words. Because now the Gray Smith, you can see the Gray Smith in the 2000, for 1999, he is defined intensive care as be defined as a service for patient with a potentially recoverable condition who can benefit from more detailed observation and invasive treatment than can safely provided in general ward or high dependency area. It is a definition will be potentially recoverable conditions only for the intensive care. For if there is no recovery, nothing, then there is no use on the ICU patients. Okay, so next is it is a usually reservoir for patient in the potential or established organ failure. The most common supported organ is lung, but facility should be exist for the diagnosis, prevention and treatment of the other organ dysfunction in the ICU. So it is in the Gray Smith is giving the nice definition in 1999. So who to admit that? A patient need life sustaining intervention who have a high probability of recovery and would have high probability of recovery. Second, would accept the cardiopulmonary resuscitation and receive a higher priority for ICU admission, and admission to the ICU should be based upon functional impairment rather than the just a severity of illness, based upon the functional impairment. Even one studies are done in 2016, in a studies of the medical for admission during 1 year, functional impairment at the time of intensive evaluation was the determining the factor influencing ICU for assistance, where patients were less likely to be admitted if their functional status were poor or they had to do not resuscitate in order. If the patient are very likely, if there will be functional impairment is less, there is no use on admit on the patients. So the patients need a potential recovery patients benefit for the ICU. Next slide. So next to the one more definition, you can see the second one. What is a critical illness? It's a medical condition usually impairs one or more vitals or organ abnormalities, which deoperatize in the patient's survival. Deoperatizing means the life threatening to the patients, as well as the each and every monitoring system of the patients, all the monitoring system giving alert about the particular patient's conditions. Next. So before I'm going to start with ICU, I want to, because my topic is actually 516, that is PT in ICU and outcome measures in ICU. But without this 1, 2, 3, 4, I cannot go to the next 516. I have to mention overview about what is that. That is, first is airways and tubes. Second is ICU monitoring. Third is life's connection. Fourth is common condition in ICU. Fifth is PT role. And sixth is outcome measures in ICU. What is airways and tube? All will be, you need to, next one. All will need to EOM. In my terminology, you are, for example, I used to call EOM. That is called, next slide, next. Eye on monitor. Always, whatever you're doing in ICU, you should keep on eye on monitor, because even simple ankle toe also can changes your BP, your blood pressures, heart rate, because you have to, that simple, within a second, it will change the dramatic. We can, patient, sometimes the patient will be 100, suddenly bradycardia. You have to see that even for the 5 ankle toe movements also. I can see a lot of patients, the critical patients. So you have to keep always eye on monitor. First two, I will see the airways and tubes. What is that? Go, next one. So basic for RV, artificial RV. So first is we have to divide it basic, supraglottic, advanced RV. Why I divided like that means, because basic RV, supraglottic RV does not that much need big skill than advanced RV. They're only done by anesthetists, surgeons, physicians only. Because so basic and supraglottic RV, we till the epiglottics, we can healthcare provider, anyone can train the BLS or ACLS train, we can do that. But advanced, like a endotracheal tube, tracheostomy tube, need advanced skill. That's why it is only that doctors can do that. This is a thing. So basic RV, what for it will be two types. One is the oropharyngeal RV and nasopharyngeal RV. Oropharyngeal RV, You have to know that, because suppose the patient's having that oral suctions, patient's not cooperative, you have to put the for OPA. It is called for oropharyngeal RV. So you have to keep and suction it. Sometimes the patient will be unconscious and tongue bite. This is will be provided by OPA, that is oropharyngeal RV. For nasopharyngeal RV, some patient have snoring, some patient difficult to oral suction, you can put the nasopharyngeal suction also, you can do the next is for us. It is next is a, for it is a supraglottic airway. First is a, for a, first one is a, for MLMA. For LMA it is called first laryngeal mask airway and second is King laryngeal tube. And the third one is a, for esophageal tracheal combi tube. Okay, so third one is a, pretty advanced survey, that is for endotracheal and tracheostomy tube. This all tubes you should know before in the entry to the ICU, because you are going to treat mechanically ventilated patients or O2 mask, whatever, you should know this basic airways. Next slide, Krupesh. So this is a monitoring system. Why I'm talking to the monitoring system? Second one, no, neurological system. Always start with our head. Neurological system, cardiovascular system, pulmonary system, monitoring of mechanically ventilations and renal function, liver function and nutrition status of the patient in the ICU. Why I'm talking this now? Because always start any patient, first you start with the neurological higher mental function, whether you have to check RASS, that is a Richmond Association scale, or GCS scale. These two scales we have to use it. After the cardiovascular, you'll see the heart rate, echocardiography. If the possible echocardiography, or the patient will be BP, whether invasive, non-invasive. For pulmonary, capnography, or intertidal carbon monoxide, and respiratory, different monitoring, and monitoring of mechanical ventilation. Monitoring of mechanical ventilation is a main important thing. Whenever I'm going to touch the patient, before I will see the patient monitor. Before I'm seeing the patient monitor will be that settings, all the FiO2, PO2, everything I will check that. Because ventilator is our machine, like our for our IFT ultrasound machine, like that. For ventilators, our machine, for usually everyday routine practice, I will see the ABG values with that correlate with to the ventilator parameter. I have some for calculations with that, I will to the tally, and after that, I will adjust the FiO2 level, PEEP level, and immediately inform to the particular consent for physician, because it will be our role to oxygen status, ventilator interaction, even simple graphics itself, it's showing a lot of knowledge about the particular things. So you should think what is the inspiration, expression, you can find out where is the problem, where is the secretion also, you can find out from the that flow volume, loop volume, all in the for ventilator graphics. Okay, next is a renal function. Renal functions, most of the for patient in ICU, you can see, you know, CKD, that is metabolic acidosis patient. What is the metabolic acidosis? Even so many today also 7 patients are metabolic acidosis patient. The metabolic acidosis patient, why the role of metabolic acidosis and chest physiotherapy? Till I am doing research on that, especially in the role of physiotherapy on metabolic dysfunction in ICU. What is the for relation between CKD and the chest physiotherapy? Third is, sixth is liver function, and seventh is nutrition status of the patient. That is also very, very important one. Next.
Rupesh.
Next is the common condition in ICU. Common condition ICU, because common condition, I'm elaborate one or two conditions only, not I'm going very depth on it because it is a very huge one. So first is ARDS, acute respiratory distress syndrome. Now you are seeing the all COVID patient, they have the first symptoms will be ARDS. It consists of three phases, exudative, proliferative and fibrotic. These three phases are there. All COVID patients going for ARDS. So that's why it is a very, very important, not only COVID patient, even CKD patient, pancreatic, all patient, it is a one type of severe respiratory distress syndrome. Next is SIRS, systematic inflammatory response syndrome. Systematic inflammatory response syndrome is nothing but it is a patient whole organ, multi-organ failure. It is giving sign about your organ, one of the organ going for failure or going for sepsis. And third is critical illness syndrome, because in the 11 condition, apart from the except three, others are because of the some other reason. Critical illness weakness syndromes only the responsible person for physiotherapist. If anything, the patient developed critical illness weakness syndrome, it is only responsible for the ICU therapist, because it is acquired disease. It is not the patient coming with this problem. The patient acquired after the ICU admission. Next, fourth one is chest trauma. Fifth is brain injury, multiple organ, lung disease, poisoning, neuromuscular shock, and dealing with the emergency situation, because sometime you are started to mobilization, the patient chances of cardiac arrest. Immediately, what you will do that? Suppose the patient have pulmonary embolism, what you will do that? Suppose the patient have massive hemoptysis, what you will do that? Immediately, you need some other thing, even in the during for emergency, our role is there. Next slide, Rupesh. So next slide, before critical illness syndrome, the first slide, one thing, the third one I told you, critical illness syndrome. It is nothing but what we call, it is a ICU acquired weakness. Because you see here in the picture, activation of protein degradation. Can you able to see this, what I'm marking? Yes? Yes? Rupesh, can you able to see this, whatever?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay, so this is what happened if the patient with coming with a renal insufficiency or cytokine or acidosis or any other endocrine dysfunction leads to activation of protein degradations in the muscle, protein degradation. Second, the patient have acute brain injury or medication because of the muscle relaxant or neuromuscular block or whatever the patient, the sedation, which leads to impaired drive to the skeletal muscles, and even tropic like hypermolarity and electrolyte imbalance and impaired energy supply. That's what I told you, the patient will be decreased intake of that leads to muscle weakness, can lead to clinical presentations of the three: muscle deconditioning, critical illness polyneuropathy, critical illness myopathy. Because why I am talking all the 11 condition, because this is called acquired weakness. Because after the physiotherapy, when the patient after the third day itself the patient developed this problem, all the mechanically ventilated, this is only responsible by physiotherapist. It is not others. I cannot blame to Edun. This is only responsible for if the patient develop this weakness, because it is only responsible for physiotherapist. So that is the first is a critical illness myopathy. What is CIM? It is a present innervation of muscle, and muscle fiber atrophy are seen in the biopsy, but decreased force generation observed in the muscle, especially profound weakness in the proximal muscles and intact sensation. Sensation will be good. Second, one more critical illness, polyneuropathy. That is what we call axonal degeneration. Weakness, decrease the DTR and alter the sensation. This both will combination will give for what we call critical illness myopathy and critical illness polyneuropathy. It is called ICU acquired weakness. Next slide, Rupesh. Rupesh. Okay. So here, you want to see that recently in 1800s, for what happened after the First World War, before that mobilization, if the patient is the best treatment is bed rest. After that, what happened? The pulmonologist or intensivist scientist name called Dr. Thomas L. Thomas Pitty. He is actually after that 1964 to till year absorbed. What are the, because he is actually the Thomas L. Pitty is always is worried about why the patient after that any other sedations or any other patient is prolonged bedridden, there is no any other movement. He's very worried about, because he's 1964 itself, he started for the ambulation, yearly ambulation. He is one of the person create the name ARDS, acute respiratory distress syndrome. He is a pulmonologist as well as intensive for therapist, and he's supporting more of the article will be mobilization, not for it will with or without physiotherapy, but most of the is concentrated on mobilizations. He's against with a sedations or drugs. Next slide. Next one is, thing. Rupesh. So you see that 1988 suspended life or extending death, Dr. Thomas Pretty compared with the today with the 1964. I told you 1964. This is article you can see the chest 1988. See that he told, I am troubled when I make rounds in critical care units today. What I see these days are paralyzed, sedated patients lying without motion, appearing to be dead except for the monitors that tell me otherwise. So what is the difference? Because all patients are sedated, they think even physiotherapists also, if the patient say for sedator or patient of artery line or patient of tube, immediately what happened, they will write the patient is on tube so-and-so. So for it will be so physiotherapist has not given like that, because even sedated patients also we need a physiotherapist. You don't think patient will be unconscious sedated. That's why the scale, before I'm going to the outcome measures, that's why the scale have come there. Next for Rupesh. So that's what I told, even sedated patients also we will give the physiotherapy. That's what he's worried about, the Thomas L. Pretty. Effect of bed rest. Here, see the first study, in healthy individual bed rest, 4 to 5% decrease maximum voluntary contraction per week. And muscle, second one, muscle mass can reduce 30% within the 10 days of ICU. And this is, next slide, Rupesh.
Diaphragm weakness.
Okay, the diaphragm weakness, this is to see that I told about that is a critical illness, myopathy or polyneuropathy. This is a diaphragm weakness in the critical ill. Diaphragm weakness, what happened when the patient will be prolonged mechanical ventilator more than 48 hours, the patient will go for diaphragmatic, not only for diaphragm, all the muscle. If the diaphragm is alone, 80% of total vital capacity. Think that if the patient extubated, how the patient will come back to normal. Because that's what we have to start the physiotherapy as soon as the patient, once the patient has stabilized. Same, the critical illness associated with diaphragm weakness also, it is showing poor outcome, including that second study, poor outcome, including critical ICU mortality, difficult weaning from, because after the 48 hours, if your patients have developed slowly weakness or acquired disease, leads to patient will be going for prolonged mechanical ventilation. Next. So here, this ICU, that's what I mentioned, acquired weakness syndrome. It is a weakness observed after a period of critical illness with organ failure, no weakness of facial cranial nerve, symmetrical flaccid paralysis, assured with prolonged mobilization, ventilator organ support, difficult to weaning. Here see that 25 to 40% patient demonstrate weakness after the mechanical ventilation more than 48 hours. 25 to 40% weakness, see that. So what we can expect in patients who are ventilated even longer? You think that if you're not giving 2-3 days, what happened? One study thousand, I didn't mention here. So within 2 days, you can see the 15% of weakness in the quadriceps muscles, or within 1 week, 50% of quadriceps muscles will, because whenever you are making patient will be dangling, high sitting, quadriceps muscle and gluteus maximus muscle power needed for any yearly ambulations. Okay, that's what I'm talking about ICU occurred, because a lot of things are there, but ICU occurred weakness, why were physiotherapists? Because it is because of that, you have to start physiotherapy as soon as possible. You have to start the patient, once the patient stabilized, you start the physiotherapy within 24 hours. Okay, next. Think that PT role in ICU, PT in ICU, I talked into PT in ICU. See that PT, you can ICU, I divided into three phases. One is first one, two, three. One is a pre-rehabilitation. What is pre-rehabilitation? Suppose some other patient going for lobectomy or any other patient going for surgery or any other ICU procedure. See that the better withstand the stress of ICU procedure and inactivity. So you need, before itself, you started all that rehabilitation, pre-exercise, pre-operative exercise regimen you have to start as soon as. Next is problem-based PT management during ICU admission. That's second one. What is a problem-based? This is during in your ICU, what you're going to give, that's second one. Third is post-discharge. After the patient shifted from the ICU, going to the ward, immediately you have to follow consent of ward people or whatever the physiotherapist you have to convey and giving all over the about the patient details, because if the patients will be whatever in for ICU after the going to the ward, you have to follow, because you should not wait for still physician re-referral again sent to that. You have to wait and you have to start for work on them till the discharge. Even the discharge also, I will show that once. I will show the one study will showing for there is a after the discharge will be the showing 5% of weakness which leads to gait pattern changes in the patient. I will show them for during post discharge acute care. First I will see the pre rehabilitations. Next slide, Rupesh. So this is a common common in all of the ICU admission patients. Why this is a problem based PT management during admission? What is the first is retained secretions, reduced V by Q. Because in that now the COVID situations, more than retained of secretion, reduced V by Q. That is a zone of rest. Because upper lobe, middle lobe, lower lobe, that is the main thing, because they have to get adequate ventilation perfusion. Next is third is immobilization and sudden onset weakness and altered function and altered ambulation status. It's all to be recovered. What we have to go there? We have to do that. So we have to do that to improve the previous. So improve the oxygenation, ventilation, airway clearance, and decrease the bedridden complication. This all, this 5 points we have to remember: improve the oxygenation, ventilation, airway clearance, mobilization, and decrease bedridden complications. Even you have to start, because especially neurological patients or neurosurgery patients, they are more prone for DVT. That's what you start to advise for the DVT compression stockings or whatever that TED stocking, acticotip, whatever that thromboembolic stockings and compression band. Everything you start for the neurological patient, not only neurological, all the patient you have to work on them. Next slide, Rupesh. So always, whenever if you see the patient, you go to the, to enter the ICU, you can see different types of patient. One is a conscious, unconscious, different patient will be with tube, without tube, without endotracheal tube, that is with or without airways, or a patient the mask, without for O2 mask or for high oxygen support, whatever, how the your rehabilitation protocol, how you each pay, all patient are we giving same treatment? No, it is differ from each and everything. Next, that is a classification of patients. Next, so that's what you have to divide the ICU patients like that. Next. That's why you have to divide it. The patient will be conscious and unconscious. Whether you have to divide, whether you have to give active therapy or passive therapy, like that also you can divide. This is my classification I did according to my understanding. That is conscious and unconscious patient. That conscious patient with mechanically ventilated, conscious patient without mechanical ventilation, unconscious patient with or without mechanically ventilated, like that. So next, so you have to again analyze that approach, the protocol. Again, you have to rework on it. So you have to choose what the next slide. So here you can see that first airway clearance, you have to see the conscious with mechanically ventilated. First you have to give airway clearance technique. Always you start with the airway clearance technique. I will explain what is that. And lung expansion therapy and weaning from the ventilator when the patient is conscious with the mechanical ventilator. When the patient GCS is good, conscious, and patient you try to wean from the ventilator. That is our main duty, as well as that is a primary. Second one is the ambulation exercise, that is a secondary. Same conscious without mechanical ventilator, what you have to do that. Without mechanical ventilator, like that, it is similar to patient in the O2 mask. You have to do the airway clearance, auscultate the patient airway clearance, lung expansion, exercise and gravity, ambulation, mobilization, and exercise prescription. Make the patient out of bed, chair sitting and standing. You have to start the aerobic fit principle. You start the frequency intensity time, because once the patient out of bed, immediately the patient transfers to the step-down unit. Again, they will start the effective rehabilitation, make the patient start with around the cot and one round, two round, like that. You have to go slowly, that progressive. You should not suddenly increase the patient will get, as well as you see the monitoring pre and post. Next, Rupesh. So next is unconscious patient. Unconscious patients, that's what I told you, active. Whatever the conscious patient, active. Unconscious patient, passive, you do that. Whether you have to first always start one of the PNF technique, best technique for unconscious patients, neurological facilitation, perioral, or whatever that perioral stimulations, costal stretch, costal basal lift. So that techniques are there, you can apply that and it will be improve the lung expansion and more concentration on arousal, or that is out of bed, chair sitting and coma stimulations, as well as the passive airway clearance technique, like chest percussion, vibration, everything you start there. And exercise and gravity stress. What happened whenever unconscious patient you make, when the patient you check that with mechanically ventilated, you see the weaning mode or whatever the mode, and see the patient should not higher PEEP or lower ventilation mode, then you can start patient put in the out of bed chair sitting, make the sit, and it is what happened, no? It will be stimulate the improve the patient arousal to activate the reticular activating system. So it will be most of the patients are improved, arousal will be improved. Instead of the patient supine lying, you make to the patient to out of bed. Similarly, unconscious patient without mechanically ventilated, some other patient, stroke patient, even the patient will be after the tracheostomy, they will keep, or the patient will be in that room air. They have to keep again neurological facilitation, concentrate out of bed, concentrate on a between concentration arousal and exercise and gravity stress. This is very, very important for like that. It is, I'm choosing according to the patients. Next slide, Rupesh. So next is always, I told you this is a different technique. So common three, I told you, you know, whenever you are going to see the patient, you are auscultating, whether you have to choose whether the patient need physiotherapy techniques to increase lung volume or techniques to clear secretion or patient need excess in gravity stress, that is rehabilitation. You have to auscultate. If the patient have secretions, then you have to start airway clearance for technique. And if the patient have to chest is clear, but what you have to do? Please at least try to change the position to increase the lung, because you think it's surface anatomy or hot what? In anteriorly, upper lobe, middle lobe only there. Upper lobe, middle lobe and very small. Posterior lobe full or in the, sorry, lower lobe full on the posterior side. So you try to, that's what in COVID patients, all they are doing prone position, because it will be improve the FRC. So prone positioning, right side lying, left side lying will be improve the patient FRC as well as improve the gaseous exchanges. What is exercise? One person asked me, what is gravity stress? Gravity stress is nothing but when I will be supine, there is no gravity because anti-gravity muscle decrease the postural muscle tone. So when I make the patient to out of the chair sitting, or if I make the patient sitting, so the gravity will act on my body. That will be what happened, will be even, it is one of the tool for the airway clearance and lung expansion also, as well as patient improve the for arousal. So that's what techniques to increase lung volume. First we'll see the techniques to increase lung volume. For Rupesh, next one. Techniques to increase the lung volume. Okay, so techniques to increase lung volume. If the patient is in the conscious, is in the mask and patient is cooperative, what, how you will increase the lung volume? Next slide, Rupesh. So controlled mobilization. Controlled mobilization, nothing but you make the patient will be controlled. You see the monitoring everything and make the patient will be dangling. That is high sitting and make the standing controlled mobilization. Because whenever if you make standing, your gravity act on your body, that is called gravity stress, automatically passive method for the lung expanding. In my patients, in my one of the protocol, even if you're asking which technique, I always prefer the third one, exercising. Because whatever the patient chest is not, the secretion not coming, I immediately make the patient will standing. If it is possible, make the one round ambulate. Automatically, the dramatic changes will seen immediately. This getting out of bed and waking up, getting out of bed is one of the fruitful technique in the cardiopulmonary physical therapy. It is explained by Elizabeth Dean in 2004, Donna 2004. The study will be published at that time. So controlled mobilization, incentive spirometry. It is increase the lung volume and CPAP. That is a continuous positive airway pressures. If it is possible, you can increase the lung. And breathing exercise. A lot of breathing exercise are there. You have to improve that. Next, Rupesh. So next is... patient for ventilated patient, what you will do? If the patient are ventilated, as I told you, you know, positioning. Positioning always will improve the patient for that increase. Next slide, increase the patient FRC. If FRC, that is, if you see that second paragraph, the turning side will increase FRC. Supine and slumped position, very bad position. And prone is it is a very good position to increase the lung expansion. If possible, left side lying and right side lying. Always, every 2 hours, you have to change the position. Nowadays, in most of the ICUs or now the recent article, what, no, instead of airway clearance, you make the patient to the positioning alone can improve the patient lung is expanding. Nowadays, there is just percussion vibrations, no need just percussion. You can start positioning alone can improve the patient pulmonary outcome. They mentioned that even if the patient, suppose the patient have any other, suppose the patient will be neurosurgery patient, what you will do? That neurosurgery patients quite very difficult. That neurosurgery patient always head and hip for 30 degree, you have to elevate for the head and for elevate 30 degree, because if you down, the intracranial pressure will be elevated. So you have to make sure that patient, head injury patient, you can know head injury patient, you can do the prone lying. Research studies are for head injury patients, you can make the prone lying and improve the lung expand, because head injury patients, or that is a neurosurgery patient, more chances of posterior basal atelectasis will be more than other patients. Okay, next, that is a zone of rest will be this. What is a zone of rest? Because I will explain the zone of rest will be, it is a giving Scott Irwin, upper lobe, middle lobe, lower lobe. If you take upper lobe, air, if you take air, that is a ventilation, always the low density, that's what it is more on upper. Lower, blood, perfusion. Perfusion always more on down. So that's what happened in middle. V by Q will be 4/5. It is 0.8. That is a respiratory question. Is 0.8. So our V by Q, you should for maintain, because especially when the patient will be right side lying, supine position and the slumped position is very worst position for the patients. It will be compressed the for viscera to the diaphragm. Make the patient will be right side lying, left side. My one of the technique out of bed, second technique I'll do always positioning before they start the therapy. Immediately you can see the effect, but you have to wait. I'll spend the one patient minimum 20 to 40 minutes. First day will be 1 hour, will take for whole assessment. Because each day will be, because I am intensive critical care physiotherapist. So I have to be in ICU for morning to evening. I will see the everyday routine, the ABG, everything I will see that. So I am the responsible for the each patient till the discharge. Sometimes the patient discharge, I will give the handouts also the patients for their review also, whatever that I can give them. Okay. So next slide, Rupesh. So next is, this is a kinetic bed. It is a Texas University. This is used in the taken picture from the Texas University. This is a kinetic rotating bed turned around along with the 180 degree. Whenever if you patients need, suppose this is and all is not available in our Indian population, some other hospital, maybe mother hospital, but it is in the UK, some other area, it is they're practicing. It is will be 180 degree fully rotated. It will be improve the gas acceptance. It is, but quite is very cost effective. Next one, Rupesh. So what is that? Whenever the patient in the mechanical ventilator, they tell the patient mechanical ventilator only chest physiotherapy positioning. After that, apart from that, you have to teach that if the patient is GCS is good, patient is going for extubation or patient, if the patient in the, I underline that assist control and SME mode, you start to tell the patient to take a deep breath along with the ventilator and breathe out. How many people are practicing? I don't know that. Because even today also one patient, I did what a patient in the CPAP mode, I started to alternately with the TP trial, and 2 hours later, again, I start a deep breath because the patient will be, again, I'll connect to CPAP because if the patient, I feel the 2-3 breath, again, he started to fatigue. So what I did now, again, I'll connect to the ventilator. Slowly I started tomorrow or day after tomorrow, they're planning for extubation of the patient. So you have to try and after the immediate extubation, start a lung expansion therapy. So deep breathing in the ventilator also very important role is there. If breathing is, we have to try and it is a Scott Irwin book, very giving, very explained in very well in this. Next, Rupesh. So next is manual hyperinflation. I told you, whenever during suctioning or whatever, if the patient need lung, particular lung, you put the patient to side lying and ventilate one particular, whichever lung you want to ventilate, same right side, left lung, hyperoxygenate. If the patient secretions are coming, you have to aspirate the secretions. Next. So next is techniques to clear secretions. Always whenever I'm going to the for ICU, I will tell the doctors, I need this patient for second hourly, fourth hourly. This is my clinical decisions. I will tell that, I will explain if they want us, because it isn't my freedom. I will explain this is a patient, which patient they need, because they believe, because I will give the definite what outcome after that particular therapy. So that's what daily, actually, if you take bi-daily, if you take daily, the gentle maintenance, if the patient, suppose the patient mechanically ventilated, I will use give for 1 day. First, I will start with the positioning, techniques to increase lung volume, right side lying, left lying. Today also one patient did for prone lying. Yesterday, one prone lying also happened because the patient to increase the lung expansion. After that, if the patient after 2 days again the secretions, then I'll work on the airway clearance technique. Suppose if the patient have moderate secretion, that is thrice daily, or if the patient have more moderate amount, fourth hourly. If the patient have copious secretion, I will give for copious secretion second hourly, especially OP poison. One patient the copious secretions now, but I started the positioning as well as the right side, left side lying, and aspirate and aspirating with the normal saline and suctioning also done by only physiotherapist. Suctioning also one because airway clearance, suctioning also I will use to put nice saline and after that I will aspirate and again I will hyperventilate the patients. Okay, next slide, Rupesh.
Sir, excuse me.
Yes.
Sir, participants are requesting you to be a bit slower.
Oh, I want to go a little bit slower. Okay. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you. That is the suctioning. Suctioning is actually, I told you, closed suction, because most of the hospital now they're having a ventilator with a closed suction system because it will be maintain the PEEP of the patients and as well as infection. So as well as closed suction, if the possible open suction also, every second hourly you do this. Before for physiotherapy, give the patient mucolytics like a mucomix, a bronic, whatever. After the physiotherapy, give the bronchodilators, any other NSAIDs, whatever that is bronchodilator, you have to give the patient will be comfortable. Okay, next slide, Rupesh. Next is exercise and rehabilitations. Always exercise and rehabilitation. First, I will concentrate on the bit. If you see that, that is mainly, if you see the second paragraph, so the patient confined to the bed need active and passive exercise with a special attention to the Achilles tendon, hip joint, around the shoulder, two joint and long head muscle. All you have to think that, because not only this is, you have to start within the patient admitted. Once they stabilize, you have to start within the 24 hours, the patient will be in the active assisted or passive mobilization. You will start that. So the fourth point, you see the vigorous active exercise should be avoided. Vigorous exercise, why? No, because the patient, while the high network support, suppose the patient have a low ejection fraction, if you give him vigorous exercise, patient chances of going for hypotension or fibrillation. When the fibrillation happens, but nothing we can do, only the shock. Because be careful when the patient in the inotropic support or any other life support. Okay, next. So safety guideline during, always I told, heart rate, rhythm, BP, oxygen saturation. Before you're doing mobilization, you see that, please don't, you have to do manually better than if heart rate is okay, but most of the respiratory rate of the monitor is not showing well. Try to calculate manually for the respiratory rate. You see the patient distress or not. And oxygen saturation and patient complaint and patient appearance. You see the patient, how the, suppose the patient will be distressed, means immediately put in the reposition and check what is the problem. Okay, next. So I told you, mobilization, getting out, up out of bed, walking, the most fruitful technique in the donor. This is explained by, in 1994, what they told the patient, we give only passive exercise. But now 2004, they explained it is a patient which is out of bed, and it's one of the most fruitful technique for the patient, explained by Elizabeth Ding. If you see the Elizabeth Ding, it is giving that. So here you can read the second point will be the walking should be brief to prevent fatigue. The patient need to spend the time with the legs dangling over the edge of the bed before standing. The patient monitor should be scrutinized, because whenever the patient is, you start with the patient is supine, first you start with the long sitting. After you make the dangling, that is legs are down, that is high sitting, then slowly you, because every time you can see the pre-vital and post-vital. See the whether the patient heart rate, suppose before is 100, after you mobilizing is for it is going to 110. Again, you wait for 2 to 5 minutes to again back to 100. Again, it is increased, that patient is cardio intolerance will be there, cardiorespiratory intolerance will be there. Then again, you will maintain and documentations and inform to the concerned physician about that. Okay, so tipping chair is usually available. Tilt table, even nowadays, all the beds are available to for the tilting bed, is helping for the patient will be tilting. Even the cardiac chair, horse chair, you can make high standing and whatever that prone lying, everything you can nowadays that tilting, whatever the bed we are available, which we make. Whatever high sitting, long sitting, and even standing also similar, how the tilt table, like the features are come there. Next slide, Rupesh.
Yeah, okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. 1 minute. Sir. Okay. So that is, next is a pumpless protocol. This is, I think for someone, it's very, maybe new. It is a protocol. It is a neuro intensive care unit. It is there, they implemented. There is a pumpless progressive upright mobility protocol. What? Nothing but it is same protocol, what we are doing, but they are making it, this will be more valid, more reliable, more, it is make it steady and make it more valuable. Because I told you, in their ICU, the lack of review of literature is very, very less. That's what research more will be in, especially in the metabolic problem, the research are very, very less. And neurosurgery also, what is the main airway clearance in the neurosurgery patients also, that review of article that sparely are available. Okay, so that's what it is. Then that first you start here, the assess the patient, the following patient risk for deconditioning. If the patient, you look at that patient is a deconditioning, like the critical illness, any other critical illness, myopathy or polyneuropathy, does patient require orthostatic training for upright position? If it is yes, if the patient is having any other deconditioning problem, immediately you have to, is patient to immobilize or ineffective mobility plus or one, you have to see whether the patient have low bar collapse, atelectasis or excessive secretions, or you see the P by F ratio. It is called oxygenation index. That is one of the, our outcome I'm going to explain in the next slide. So PF ratio, it is a less than 300. If the patient lungs oxygenations, they need more what demand is there. That's what you have to concentrate. PF ratio is less than 100. You have to check in the ABG. After that, you should not start any other pro, any other. If greater than 300, you can go ahead because oxygenations will be parameters good. Next, you see the for hemogenic instability is there with the manual tanning. If it is there, if this all collapse, whatever the oxygenation index, everything will be fine. Then you start with the pumpless protocol, that is called pumpless steps, which is it is progress each steps to 30 to 60 minutes. Each step must be implemented at least one. It is what is plus means next to next. Suppose this is step head and elevation for 45 degree in the cardiac chair. I will show the chair. It is a cardiac chair or it will in the bed. We have a host chair. You have to start with the head and elevate 45 degree. Step two, 45 degree plus with the dependent position. Step three, head and same 45 degree plus full dependent position. That is a full bed chair mode cardiac chair. And step four, head and elevation 65 degrees and the patients will be in dependent position, feet on the floor and standing on the place that you make the whole cot will be straight. So immediately you see that any other vitals, any other abnormalities, immediately put in the back the patients and see that how the recovery heart rate, BP, everything you want, ion monitor, always ion monitor. If the patient having intolerance, put him back. And next day you have to try, you have to wait for the one day, you have to try on the next day. Okay. Next is same for similarly, it's same if the patient, I told assess the patient, if the patient have, doesn't have any other deconditioning, directly you can mobilize the patient and go start with the step seven. Steps, what is 5, 6, 7, you can start there. What is the steps 5? Initial standing position, pivot into the chair. Step 6, what they're telling you, what that is, plus transfer standing from bed to chair, 2 to 3, meals with standing, not exit 45 minutes. And step 7, ambulate within the room using assisted device and extra personnel as needed, 20 feet. Step 8, slowly you want to ambulate with the hallway, assistant device and extra person as needed. Like you see step 10, step 11, ambulate without coaching or supervision, may use device if necessary. See, they are using available that cart with them. They made this much such a beautiful study. I gave the reference also in that down. You can please check that reference and follow that reference. It is even neurosurgery patients, because I told neurosurgery patients, you have to be careful. If suppose the patient intracranial pressure is increases, some other hospital doesn't have a monitor. If the patient have, the, because mostly I used to see, the patient bradycardia along with the hypertension, then immediately I'll inform to the physicians, because our hospital doesn't have intracranial pressure for some other. If they have the doubt, immediately they do the CT scan. Immediately they do CT scan, then the ruler, because the patient you should to protect from that any other further injury. Okay, next slide, Rupesh. Pumpless protocol, and this is mobilizations. Next slide, Rupesh. This is, I will tell the yearly mobilization already discussed. Next slide. So this is some other different devices are available. There is a few things only whatever if now recently they are used, started to using some other hospitals. Even that we have that new body weight supported. We started to do the all the TheraBand and pulmonary acute pulmonary rehab state. That is a subtle mini press. Resistive bands and the port of leg ergometer, Movio, Arjo standing equipment, standing gate, walking, different. Next slide, Rupesh. That is a shuttle mini press. It is not available, but I searched in the article from that I collected. So place on the bed, you have to strengthen the quadriceps muscles, because I told quadriceps, gluteal maximus to need a power to make the patient out of bed and sit. Because at least gluteus, if it's not possible, try to strengthen the quadriceps muscle. I told one of the primary muscle going for ICU acquired weakness patient. That's what acquired, I told you, it is the only responsible for physiotherapist. Next one. Next is bicycle ergometer. Now we are used to see the bicycle ergometer and custom whatever you made like that. We have the bicycle active and passive cycle ergometer to improve the quadriceps short term recovery. Even the ventilated patient, this patient receiving the continued renal replacement therapy, even they started, because you think that whenever some patient telling whenever the patient on that for dialysis, hence the physiotherapy is not giving who, because the patients even dialysis also we will start some sort of rehabilitations, because you should not make, because continue renal replacement all going for whole day. Some other patient dialysis for here in India, most of the year they're giving intermittent renal replacement. Intermittent means not a kind of, for it is not continuous. You have to start with that also. You can 5 hours minimum, 5 to 6 hours it's going there. So what happened British before almost 6 hours, what happened, you can start some isometric ankle movement, some necessary precautions. The criteria, you should follow the standardized protocol. Next question. this Movio and Bato, different their company is there. Next, all are physiotherapy. And this is, I told you, total lift about that steady pumpless protocol. This is a chair they made about standing weightless, because even all cord now, we have a lot of cord will be like that. So hence we are doing like that. But what happened, that patients, most of the patients are cardiac intolerant, tachycardia. After that, we are putting, after that patient back to the normal, we are minimum taking for 20 minutes back to that. Immediately they started, we have to roll out, it is take time. Some other patient will have good results. So I used to start always around the bed, one round ambulation like that. I used to start the patients. Next. So I asked questions whenever I see the patient. So does it, so it should all start here, but does it? So what I tell you, whenever the patient are ventilator dependent, sedated, neuromuscular blockade, as an arterial line, as a chest tube, or patients are uncooperative, immediately physiotherapy is done. Again, what is the point? If same patient repeating for 1-2 seconds, all sedated for 3 days also, we will do like that. What happened? Which studies are saying physiotherapy arm and during and set for sedated patients? Studies are told in, for instance, physiotherapy will start as far as the, according to the Richmond agitation scale. Next, that is outcome measures. We are going to discuss that only. So what I'm taking, so what you have to start as soon as possible, you have to start there. Don't see that this arterial, because even some other, even today, whenever in daily practice, I'm seeing the patient will be arterial, and you have to see, because the patient central line and all, it is very, very difficult to put, because if you are not knowledge of the particular line, for that's what I mentioned in the fourth hour for overview about ICU, I told life connection, nothing but whatever that the patient have ECMO, for ECMO membrane, or whatever the femoral line, and even the patient will be in the IABP, whatever it is, you have to necessary, if nowadays they started our mobilization also. Next slide, Next slide, you see that this is a ECMO membrane, patient in the extracorporeal membrane auxiliary support, they will be made standing. Next is the ventilated patients. Third, you see that femoral line, even we are mobilizing, they told patient on the femoral line, hence I cannot bend the knees. It is not necessary, because you see the necessary, because you have to secure the line and take necessary, because sometimes without knowledge of kink, or it will be come out very, again, difficult to do the central line, especially if that central line, the neck and all, they will bring to the OT and they will do in the central line. Please be careful with that particular thing. Next to Rupesh. So I told, you know, first stage pre-rehabilitation over, and second rehabilitation during the ICU. This is a post-rehabilitation. I told you, post-rehabilitation, once the patient from the ward discharged from the to the hospital, what happened? How many people you are following, whether the patient, I've seen some other patient, I've given my number, whatever, that come back to the OPD basis. Few patients are coming with the deficits. That is, I told you, especially deconditioning that patient, you have to train that patient with the proper aerobic protocol. We can give at least, if it is not possible, weekly once or monthly, whenever review, at least we make the patient to show that whatever the program. Nowadays it will be, we have to use to WhatsApp based, that is a WhatsApp based for a protocol. I will send the picture, then what are the exercises they're doing, they will send the pictures to back to me. That is, we can do like that, social media, a lot of social media, that you can make the home-based, like it is what we call, through the phone call, you can make actively participate the patients. You take care of the patients, we are healthcare provided, you have to concentrate on that also. So that transfer from the patient, one studies are, that is in the 2011, ICU acquired weakness, it's ubiquitous, and recovery may be incomplete after 5 years after the discharge. So rehabilitation should be continuous from admission to follow. Even the study coming 2011, before that it's also mentioned, but how many people yet to their following after the ICU patient? That is all your, because in ICU I will take, after the patient shifted to ward, I will consult the patient will be, because I told, no, sir, how I can strengthen up this, I can follow this everything, because from the ICU to ward, from the discharge, means by the only way, outcome measure. That's what measuring the worth for the physical therapy is, outcome measure. Have you mentioned your physical therapy? What are the outcome measures? You have to see that. What are the outcome measures you're doing? It is giving about whole condition of the patients more than yours, because first day you're doing only assessment. It will take next day onwards. You think about it, sir, it is take very long. Don't think it long, because it is very easy. First day only, it will take long. Next day onwards, you just make so format, and you concentrate more on outcome measures. What are lagging? What are the chest component? What is the limb component, physical function, what is the pulmonary outcome? You have to concentrate, then you have to, what is that patients have a lack, then you have to work on it. Then you can complete within that patient, you will send the with satisfactions will be happened. That's what I told, you know, cardio pulmonary physical therapy is a base, purely it is on evidence based practice. Even I told you, you know, if you take the musculoskeletal or neurological patient, it will take 1 day or 1 week, or even for the take for months also, sometimes more than 6 months also. But in cardiopulmonary, if you go into the airway clearance, within a 20 minutes you can see the dramatic changes. Such a beautiful, that I told in auscultation before that, after that, if you're seeing that they're beautiful within a 20 minutes for one lung per specialist, but the one bronchopulmonary segment, you can see that you've never seen anywhere else such a thing, immediate improvement. You can see the SpO2 level, even oxygenation parameter, whatever, that immediately dramatic changes will be there in the only in the cardiopulmonary physical therapy, critical care physiotherapist. Okay, next slide, Rupesh. So this about the PT role and outcomes, that next time, sir, this many component you are mentioning, sir. So how that will be, whether are you following this, do we doing the outcomes really? No. Whenever you're seeing the right side of the picture, when they're seeing that lot of syringe pump is there, then you, for everyone will think, sir, syringe pump is there, patient is sick, so patient, you're right. Patient, even they will syringe pump, they will sedate, that what your duty, you have to measure that valuable. Before I'm going to the all the outcomes, this one more outcome will be that this two outcome, one of the more very valuable for the sedation patient, that is called Richmond Agitation Sedation Scale. It is agitation. What is agitation? See, you think about, I will always work on it, some research work on it for particular this only, because whenever patient, you think that you're going to start the patient will be chest physiotherapy, patient not cooperate, then you read patient not cooperate, ends, I'll discuss with the doctor, I will discontinue. You should not do that. Patient, most of the ICU patient, they are not coming by walking, they are coming brought out to the ICU. Immediately they opening the eyes, they will see the all light is on, and which is the day, which is the night also, they don't know. Even the patient will develop where we are, and they think whether we are in the surgery, in the operation theater, the patient will develop delirium, fear, that called ICU psychosis, which ICU psychosis leads to patient have a behavioral disturbances. What is behavioral disturbance? Because of the ICU psychosis, the patient having neurotransmitter level changes will be there. That is called behavioral disturbances will be there. We have to work on it. That's what, even whenever the patient have ICU psychosis, one patient have low for lobectomy, I treated last month. So for immediately the patient not cooperative and he started to screaming, then immediately I told the doctor, I will be there, disconnect from that artery line, everything. And after that, disconnect from the central line and made it to the wheelchair. And the patient have a right side for intercostal drainage, then immediately I bring to the out of the ICU. Then I showed the patient, he look at the outside daytime, and he started to talk in the attendant. Slowly, that ICU psychosis in there itself, we've seen the patient will be improved from the ICU psychosis. After that, next day onwards, he started to cooperate with the attendant itself, I'm doing that. So please, you should make, don't think about and work on it. This is a your clinical decision rule. This is a purely on your clinical decision. It is a cardiopulmonary physical. I told you, it is your decision how you are bringing to the patient will be normal. Okay. So that's what Richmond Agitation Sedation Scale, what they're talking about, because it is a, if text -5 to +4. What is -5? Unarousal. Because the patient, what is sedation scale, sir? What is it? Because the patient will be having sedation psychosis, then they started for sedated the patient, because whether fentanyl or dexmed or whatever the neuromuscular like a macronium, whatever, they will start to give and sedate the patients. What immediately, what you have to assess the patient, if -5, unarousable, there is no response to voice or physical stimulation, you have to mention RESS -5. R is -4, deep sedation, no response to what, but movements are eye opening to physical stimulation, giving painful stimulation, you will respond. -3, moderate sedation. -2, light sedation. -1, the patient will be drowsy, not fully alert, but has sustained awakening more than 10 seconds. And zero, Rupesh, next one, zero, it will be spontaneously pay attention to this therapist as well as staff nurse. +1, patient will be anxious, but movements not aggressive, vigorous. +2, agitated, frequency unpurposeful movement, fight with the ventilator. Most of the patients, whenever you are treating, the patient will be the ventilator alarm. Immediately, what we'll do, you go to silent alarm. We should not do that. What patient is doing, the auto patient will be started, will be against fighting with the ventilator, whether it is a ventilator problem or whether it is a problem in the tube, endotracheal tube, any block, or whether you have a problem with the patient, you have to rule out. because which leads to patient distress. That is the one important thing you want to do that. And plus three is a very agitated, plus four is combative, over combative, violent and immediate dangerous to self. That's why the patient will be sedated. You have to work on it. Whenever the patient will be minus one, zero and plus one is our the physiotherapist can do whatever the patient like, what you want. If the patient able to out of bed or making the standing, everything early intervention, you can start that, okay? So from that you take minus five, minus four, minus three, minus two. Sir, what I can do for minus five, minus four, or plus three, plus four, what I have to do that? There is also one study proved how to do the rehabilitation for that. Next slide, Rupesh. Next slide. That is if Richman agitation scale, minus five, minus four, passive range of motion. RASS minus three, minus two, passive or make to sit. RASS minus one, zero, plus one, active, active exercise, sit, stand, walk, and ADL training. You have to start ADL training as progress as tolerated. Still the hospital discharge. See that, see the patient is sedated. You should not write patient are under sedation, patient not, patient GCS is low. You should write then means physiotherapies we are not giving. You should not tell like that. Okay, even next slide. Next is like Glasgow Coma Scale. Sir, when I can assess that? If the patient minus five in RSS, fully unarousable, if you assess GCS, it's showing all will be lower score. That is 3/15. You should not do like that. When the patient will come back to minus one or minus two to plus one or above that, you can start to do the your GCS. GCS will tell about your brain, level of brain injury. You can use whenever the patient will be minus five in RSS, if you're measuring GCS will be again three, it is wrong. When the patient, if the doctors has to stop the sedation, the patient come back to normal, then how this your score will be in that GCS will be showing wrong. So always GCS will be start when the patient will be minus two, one, zero or plus one like that, you can start that. Okay, next Rupesh. So now I'm coming the outcome measures in the main topic of our that worth of physical therapy, physiotherapy outcomes. Physiotherapy outcomes, always I will work on it, that will be two outcomes are there. This is what I understand in the ICU. I taken like first is for Rupesh, next one for next pulmonary outcome. Second is wait. Pulmonary outcome. Next is a physical functional outcome. What is pulmonary outcome? Chest outcome. First you concentrate on chest. Always see that all the patient in that, whether neurological or whatever the patients, after neurosurgery, general surgery, MICU, SICU, whatever the patient, first they want to the patient weaning from the ventilator or airway for clearance. Once the patient will be airway clearance, then they shifted to step down unit. Think that they are mainly the doctor in the ICU work on the patient, especially the primary problem, as well as save. I told you, no, it is a potentially recoverable conditions in the ICU. That's what pulmonary outcomes is very, very, very important. I told you, no, pulmonary outcome, you can give an immediate guarantee to the patients. If immediately you can for immediate guarantee to improve your pulmonary outcomes. What are the pulmonary outcomes? First, it is oxygenation parameter. Next, Rupesh, slowly. Yeah. First is auscultation. I told you, know, always it is one of the best tool, auscultation stethoscope. We only know how to do that auscultation, that what work on it. You have to auscultate every day. You can, I told you, it is one of the very good tool, whether you have to increase bed sound, decrease bronchial breathing and decrease practice. Next is radiology. Radiology, you have to see always bedside the patient will be whatever we used to have the bedside, all the chest x-ray means the digital chest x-ray. We used to see every day serial ABG, serial chest x-ray, we'll see that. Third is observation, SpO2. I will see the always the SpO2 level and the muscle strength. Muscle strength also important criteria for patient to improve the oxygen parameter. Even if you have see the grip strength, whenever the patient going for extubation, they will see the grip strength of the hand and the muscle strength, overall the muscle strength, then only they will extubate it. Okay, next is the fourth and fifth, you see that PAO, that is called oxygen index and the AA gradient. Oxygenase index and AA gradient. What is that oxygenase index and AA gradient? Because nowadays in COVID patients, you think that one of the best outcome, oxygenase outcome is fourth and fifth, that is oxygenase index and AA gradient. What is that, sir, oxygenase index? Next slide, Rupesh. So pulmonary outcome, you understand this will be fourth. So before that, I'm going to the oxygenase index AA gradient. I want everyone know about the ABG, that is pH, what is the measure about acid base, PCO2 measure the ventilation, PO2 measure the oxygenation of gas exchange, Bicarbonate will be metabolic disturbances. Base excess will be measured the metabolic disturbances. Yes, SCO2 is showing about the measure of oxygenation of the gut. You have to know the ABG, because we, physiotherapists, always you have to play with the ABG, let oxygen outcome. Every day you can see the dramatic changes. Next slide, Rovish. Next, oxygenation formula. I told you, oxygenation index. Even this, I told you, in COVID patients, first sign, this is the exudative phase. First 1 week, you should not give any physiotherapy, means just percussion vibration. You have to do only prone lying. Now we are all doing prone lying. We are also doing prone lying only, but here I am not treating that much for COVID patients. So here prone lying, we have to exudate because it is inflamed stage. If you're giving again percussion, this is think that ERDS, that is COVID, that is acute respiratory distress syndrome. It is a problem on not in the lung. It is mainly not in that airways, mainly it in the alveolar capillary membrane. It is a capillary membrane will be inflamed. So what happened? Gaseous exchange won't be take place. It is like one type of sudden insult. So that insult, you should wait. It will be recovery. First stage is 1 to 7 weeks. Second stage is 2 weeks. Third stage will be fibrotic phase. Then only you have to start to work on the physiotherapy for the effective lung expansion, whatever it is. Normal value, what is that? If you take greater than 350 ml, wait, Rupesh, go back. Okay. Greater than 350 ml is a normal, I told you, in a zone of waste ventilation perfusion. If lesser than 300, acute lung injury, that is a moderate sun, that is a V by Q, mismatching will be there abnormally. Lesser than 200, severe acute respiratory distress syndrome, severe V by Q, that is gases, ventilation perfusion, severe compromise will be there. This is one of the highest reliable tool for the oxygen index. You can use for all the patients for the pneumonia, other patient, you can use this oxygen parameter. Next, I'm talking to the AA gradient. Next slide. Next one. Okay, wait. AA, what is A? A means alveoli, small a means per arterial. So alveolar arterial gradient, what is that? Whenever I told you, it is a pulmonary capillary membrane, alveolar arterial gradient, you want to, that is PA alveolar minus P small a O2, that is arterial. That is a alveolar capillary membrane as well as in the P O2 in the arterial blood. So next. PaO2, because if you calculate PaO2, that is for alveolar, always the formula will be 700 into FiO2 minus PaCO2 into 1.25. That is, I'm taking only one PaO2. That is 700. What is 700 means? It is a formula, but I can tell it is atmospheric pressure. Here, if you take Bangalore, it is around 698, 670, 680 minus hydrostatic. Hydrostatic pressures, it is, the formula will be, each area it will be different. For 700 is a common shortcut for equation, 700 FiO2 minus PaCO2 in 1.25, what is meant, that is V by Q, that is respiratory quotients, 0.8, that is 1.25. Next, Rupesh. What is the normal, sir? 0 to 20 millimeter mercury is normal. A gradient, if how the calculation, age plus 10 divided by 4. Suppose if the person age is 70, 70 plus 10 equal to 80 divided by 4. So what? 20. So this is the normal value is 20. Next, for example, you can see the one example. So pH is 7.4, PCO2 is 40, PaO2 is 95, bicarbonate 25, patient on room air, not in any ventilator, O2, patient on room air, just 20, room air is a 21%, you know that, no room air, 1 liter equal to 24, that is you can add like that. So there's a room air is a 21%, how you will calculate, apply the formula, come next. PaO2 equal to 700 into 0.21 minus 40, PCO2 is a 40, 1.25 minus, so 147 minus 50 equal to 97. So it is this PaO2 equal to 97. So from that 97, you have to minus this 95. Next, Rupesh. So here, next, previous one. So I cannot see that. Okay. Awesome. Okay. So here that is what the 90, what happened? Okay. So now you see the 97.95 equal to That is two. Sorry, it is a two. My mistake. It is two. So the patient room air is A gradient V by Q. Ventilation perfusion is normal. If the patient is above, it is increased to, it is above 20, 40, 100, 200 in a severe for ARDS pulmonary edema, for severe ARDS patient, it will show it is increased to 100, more than 100 severe diffusion defect, perfusion diffusion defect. That is a main thing for our physiotherapy. Next one, our patient. Next is analysis. Axon based status, Auger's index, and A gradient provide on information on present condition of patient and extend the utility of chest physio. Whether you can see this A gradient Auger giving, whether you ought to need patient need a lung expansion therapy or airway clearance therapy. You have to work how many people are practicing this Auger's index and A gradient is in everyday routine practice. Except I'm asking to the ICU therapist. PGs, MPT cardio, those who are taking MPT cardio, or especially in the PGs, how many people are you using this formula? That's what my questions, whether you are using in pulmonary outcome. Because most of the patients have this, even normal lung patients also, you can use and check the routine practice. So that's what is giving idea about your clinical decision, whether you want to give ventilation or airway clearance. Next, Rupesh. Next is the main component, physical outcomes tools for ICU. Because there is a lot of outcome measure scorings are there. Lot of outcome scoring there. From that, I'll taken almost 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 outcome measures. 7 outcome measures. Rupesh can minimize, I can't say 8 and 9. Okay. 7 outcome measures I will check in the different journal with a reliable, with a different one each our scoring with the measure which is a reliable. I taken 7 outcome measures for current practice. Even I am also using around 4 among these 8 scoring. So here you think that 8 and 9 FIMS level of evidence is low, reliable, less reliable than ICE, because FIMS is now before onwards, even I used to use FIMS only then, because FIMS you can use from other patients is different, but in ICU lot of scoring systems are there, especially and next is 6 minute walk test, steps test, and 4 meter 4 meter gait speed. Even if the patient in ICU you have the setup for 30 meter corridor, you can practice. Otherwise if the patient from ICU to shifted to ward, at the time of discharge you can practice 6 minute walk test and step test. Step test also you can do that. Step test, what is the normal step test? It is a 30 centimeter couch, the 30 centimeter bench. You will be step up and down for the 3 minutes, and they checking your recovery heart rate. From that they will say whether your fitness level, endurance, it is a one type of endurance level, you can check that. And 4 meter gait speed, no, it is consist of first 1 meter is a acceleration phase, 4 meter is a the testing phase, and for another 1 meter is a deceleration phase. From that 4 meter, no, the patient to start at a usual speed, and the patient we have to count within the 4 minute how many cadence, how many meter per second he covered. From that we can say that the patient, if the patient 4 meter gait speed, if the patient having greater than 1 meter per second, then the patient have a make patient to discharge from the hospital. If the patient less than 0.4 meter per second, then the patient have chances of risk of fall, and patient you have to discharge will be necessary, you have to discuss with that physician. This is giving 4 meter gait speed, no, especially ARDS patient. Recently the results are going 4 meter gait speed more reliable, especially for the patient with ARDS patient, and all the patient you can apply whenever the patient going for discharge. 6 minute walk test, step test, 4 meter gait speed there. And FIMS also you can use. I'm not telling FIMS also, but lot of scores is score. Not only this, along with 7D Motex and one more lot of short physical form battery, lot of tests are there, because this 7 score you can use the practice. It is more on reliable, validity and reliability will be there. First is a functional status score, FSSICU. Second is a physical functional outcome measures, PFIT. Third is Chelsea critical care physical assessment tool. Fourth is ICU mobility scale. Fifth is surgical optimal mobilization score. Sixth is Manchester mobility score. Seventh is Permi ICU mobility score. So I told in the first two, one and two is in that I analysis almost the review of literature, 1 and 2 are highly reliable for ICU, those who are ICU, you are from the ICU patients. Whenever that before discharge you do this test, it is more reliable giving the physical function. That is a physical function outcomes of the patient, because in the physical function outcome, which will be giving about the confident whether the patient after discharge, you can give some ideas about that. Okay. So this all scores will be, you have to make your routine practice more than this. Each scoring system giving idea about whether if you're doing all that, if suppose you take Chelsea physical assessment tool, it will be help to you that every system from the chest to till their mobilization, till the mobilization you're giving. If suppose you are missing to any component, it asking the question why you are missing the component every day. After that, because if you have to, no, suppose if you want to do the mobilization for the next day, if you're not doing the mobilization after that day, the score will show low. So what is your missing component? It will help you for your routine everyday analysis. More than your assessment, that outcome measures are very, very important, because in cardiopulmonary, there is a more and more lag in ICU scoring system. That's what this webinar also, I'm taking functional outcome measures in ICU. It is my main topic of today. So I will talk one by one. First we'll talk about the functional status score. Rupesh, can you go next? So before that, I'm choosing ICU mobility outcome tool. We have to tool the measurement will be validity, reliability and responsiveness and clinical utility, like that cost, training, equipment required, and third is patient capacity, psychological and physical. This everything I analysis. This all thing I analysis current 2000, current till day 2019 January, till the 2019 January, February, it is a very effective tool. Next year, we have to do the analysis, how many studies are reported. Everything I given the evidence, if you have a doubts, you can go with it, it will show this particular study. Next, okay. Physical function, functional status score for the ICU intensive care means it is consist of rolling, super, it is categories are pre-ambulation, ambulation category. I told you, please understand this. This physical functional outcome scoring concentrate on patient's ambulation, especially out of patient ambulation, physical function, not especially on the chest. Mainly it's concentrated physical function. I told you a lot of outcome measures. Still after that you have confusion, I will tell which tool is good for that particular ICU patient. So now you can see that this is a rolling, supine to sit transfer, unsupported sitting, ambulation category, sit to stand, ambulation. So 5 components are there. So 0 to 7, what is 0 to 0? Unable to perform. 1, total assistant. 2, maximum assistant. 3, moderate assistant. 4, minimal assistant. 5, supervision. 6, moderate independent. 7, completely independent. See, you have to, this is 5 categories there, rolling, supine. If you take rolling, the patient is everything. If suppose you take, I'm talking to you. So my score, if I'm taking functional status score, all will be 7, 7, 7. So total 5 into 7, 35 is the maximum score I reached. 35. Suppose the patient will be, all will be 0, 0, 0. So the 0 out of 35. So it is giving very simple score, but more valuable giving that routine. You should write first is a chest outcome, that is a pulmonary outcome in a separate column. Same you are writing the physical outcome in a separate column. As well as if you want measuring some other additional scoring also, you can measure that. RASS, I told you, GCS, that is will be separate column. You have to mention that. I have to giving clear explanation about that. Next is Rupesh. Next is physical function ICU test score. Physical function ICU test score, I analysis PFITU is one of the highest level of evidence. Seriously, it is one of the highest level of evidence during the discharge. It is giving, if you see the study, it will be giving highest level of evidence. It is a higher one because it is having 4 component, sit to stand, marching on the spot, and muscle strength for the shoulder flexion as well as knee extension. Shoulder flexion as well as knee extension. It is used for Oxford or manual muscle testing scale. It's 1 by 1, 4 component. Next to the slide, Rupesh. See that first is shoulder flexion, second is knee extension, third is sit to stand, 4th march on cadence. You have to start with, once the patient you make to out of bed or where patient is fit for that, you can start as well as. Next slide, Rupesh. Wait, one by one. Okay. So first you have to always start with the manual muscle testing. Oxford scale, what is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So you know 3 elimination of gravity, 4 minimum or 5 is a maximum. No need to more go on under depth on it. Next slide will be. Next. So you have to start scoring the muscle strength. See that scoring here 0 to 5 is different. Here you see that shoulder strength and knee extension strength. You have to start with, go to the previous slide, previous picture, previous. See here, first one, shoulder flexion and knee strength. How they're doing shoulder strength. Just you assess the how they just, no need to special skill to position, just to make the patient when they're sitting, comfortable sitting, high sitting or a chair sitting, then you can start. This is your predictions of how the patient will be in the which level. Next. Here you have to see the 0, 1, 2, 3. Subtotal equal to 0 to 3. So shoulder strength 0 equal to, if the patient shoulder strength 0, that is complete paralysis, no contraction. 1, there is a flicker. 2, if the patient have the elimination of gravity, then you can score 0. Suppose the patient is against gravity, make 1. If the patient minimal resistance, 2. If the patient's full resistance, 3. Like that, you have to give the score. Same knee strength also, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, like that. Before actually, that scale first actually 4, 5 components are there. After that, modified it to 4. This is about this PFIT. Next is sit to stand. Sit to stand, again you go to the previous that picture. Sit to stand, you want to start to make the patient, whether you have to see the sit to stand, whether patient sit to stand, whether the patient need completely, whether 2 persons are required, or they record for 1 person, or they need to support with the rest, or the patient independently can do that. That is whether they sit to stand. Go to the next. See that sit to stand, if the patient zero, unable, even if he's in maximum support also, you can't, patient not unable to make stand, then it is 0. If the assist with the 2%, it is a 1. If it is a 1%, it is a 2. If there is no assist, it is considered as a no assistant will be, patient will be, power is good. That is 3. Only physical assistance good. Next, marching the cadence. Again, you go to the previous marching the cadence. March will be, you have to see that the patient should be, each step should be clear, each foot should be clear from the floor. One step up, 1, 2, 3, 4, like that. You have to step over that. You have to count for 3 minutes. Whether you have to go to the next slide. Count for the next slide. See that here. Cadence, if patients unable 0, if there is a greater than 49 steps or 50 to 1, if it is a 50 less than 80 is 2, if the patient 80 plus, then you can see the maximum score. You see that if the patient is able to march on the spot 3 minutes, they achieve the maximum score is 3. If the patient achieve the score is 3, if the patient achieve the maximum, you can give like that is a marching the cadence. So the 4 component I explained that. From that, next slide. From that, you can analyze shoulder strength, knee strength, sit to stand, cadence. So you have to measure this finally, total component 0 to 12, you can use which is the least score, maximum score, you can do that. Okay, this is one of the important, highly level of evidence is high for the physical outcome measures. Next is Chelsea Critical Care Assessment Tool, but it is my routine practice. I used to take this Chelsea critical, but it think 10, it is a 10 component. First time those who are taking assessment, it will take very difficult. After keep on your practice, it will be very, very easy. First component, respiratory function. Second is a cough. Third is a bed mobility. Fourth is a supine to sitting on the edge of the bed. Fifth is a dynamic sitting. Sixth is the sit to stand. Seventh is the standing balance. And eighth is a transferring from bed to chair. Nine is stepping. 10th is a grip strength. So you have to each component, you have to analyze from, it is a like grade, it is not scoring, it's a grade 2 grade. You have to put 0 to 5. Next slide. So 0 to 5, if you take the respiratory component, whether always again you use the skull like a sedation skull RS is -5, how it will be that completely sedated like that. You can think about that particular scale. You are for C, you can look level 0 completely ventilator dependence, mandatory breath, maybe a fully sedated or paralyzed patients will be, there is no effort, completely paralyzed, then your respiratory function is 0. If the patient taking next level is 1, suppose the patient taking some other assist control, patient taking effort, then it is a 1. If the patient spontaneously breathing with a non-invasive support, like a CPAP, BiPAP, then you can give level 2. If the patient is 3, patient will be having high flow greater than 15 liter, then you can give the patients, we can give grade 3. If the patient receiving less than 15 liters of oxygen, then 4. If the patient in the room air self-ventilating with no oxygen therapy, then it is a level 5. So respiratory function, which level you ought to give them. Next is cough, also similar, absent or in the 0. Cough stimulated on deep suctioning, if you're giving cough stimulated, then it is a level 1. Weak, ineffective, voluntary cough, unable to clear independently, requires deep suction. If the patient able to cough, but he's not bring out the secretion, then immediately what happened? We'll give for the oral suction or whatever the endotracheal suction to clear the secretion, then it's level 2. Next, 3 is a weak, partially effective voluntary cough. Okay. And 4 is effective cough, clear secretion with always airway clearance technique. And 5th is consistent effective patient, whatever giving chest physio, he is able to cough voluntarily and bring out the secretion, level 5. Like that, you can see the moving within the bed, how the unable and initiate the movement requires 2 or more people, it's level 1. If the patient at least 1 person, it is a moderate, at least more than 1 person to 1, if to 1 person minimal. If it is independently greater than 3 seconds, then it is level 4. If it is a 5, it is less than 3 seconds. If the patient is doing the less than 3 seconds. Similarly, supine to sit on the edge on the bed, dynamic, that is a supine to sit the edge on the bed, unable. 2, you see that level 5 will be independently less than 3 seconds, he is able to do that. So you can score like that, because in most of the patient you can score will be day 1 to day 5. You see that scoring, this Celsius score will give. Similarly, you see the next dynamic sitting also. Dynamic sitting, when the patient sitting on the edge of the bed, unsupported, make the dangling, that is high sitting without support, you have to check the patient. First is unable, patient not unable is 0. If the requires assistant 2 or more people is 1. Then, and record for 2 persons, it's level 2. If it's a 1 person, it is a level 3. If it is the patient will be in the independent, some dynamic sitting balance, and dynamic sitting balance, that is a trunk able to flexion and whatever the support, will be level 4. If the level 5, independent with full dynamic sitting balance, able to reach out the base of support, that is level 5. Like that, next slide, Rupesh. Next slide, it is a standing balance. Like that, you have the standing balance, sit to stand in the 90 degree and transferring from the bed to chair, stepping. It always from unable to independence is giving 0 to grade 5. You have to score which level, whether patient need minimum, moderate or high level of support. Grip strength, you have to use that jammer or whatever that strength, because it is a need for jam. But otherwise you can use for some other hold, how the tell it to patient hold the grip, you can check that, because grip strength alone can give the patient how to extubate, and even extubation grip strength only they are measuring with the patient strength. 0 is unable and 1 is less than, and 5 is greater than 80%. This is about the Chelsea assessment tool. It is one of the good tool, but this one's things, physical outcomes score will cover from chest as well as the patient physical function, that is ambulation also. Next score, next. Okay. Next, okay. IC mobility scale also, suppose some other patient, they want to only purely, if you want the patient will be chest is clear, everything you want to make out of bed and chair sitting only, this IC mobility scale will be help lot. The patients you want to purely physical function, patient will be exercise level, how to bring it out of bed and concentrating on the, especially what we call, what we tell that patients, physical function status. Okay, so that 0 is nothing, patient lying on the bed. 1 is sit in the bed, exercise it in the bed itself, active exercise If the patient is able to do that, is one. If the passively move from the chair, if the patient, we bring the patient from the supine to the chair, then it is two. Three is sitting over the edge of the, that is dangling, that is making high sitting, that is a three. And transferring, standing, it is from weight from the standing, and transfer, fifth is transferring bed to chair. From bed to chair, able to step up and standing on the chair. This is involves actively transferring. And the sixth is march on the spot. You can tell the patient stand in the, make that, tell her to the what we call the marching on the spot. That is able to walk spot on the alternate at least four times or twice on each foot with or without assistance. Then seventh is walking with assistance of two people. Eighth is one person. Ninth is walk independently with aiding, and the 10th is walking independently without aid. That is minimum the walking away from the bed, patient independent at least 5 meters without gated or assistance from another person. Then you can give the 10-0 to 10 scoring. It is ICU mobility scale. Next is surgical ICU. This is a surgical ICU. What we can, especially I searched for the, especially for the neurosurgery ICU patients or whatever the general surgery, any other ICU patient, you can use this surgical, that is surgical ICU optimal mobilization score, that is SOM 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Zero is no activity. What is no activity means? Here the first box, no stable spine. If the patient doesn't have the stable spine, there is a spinal cord injury, intracranial pressure greater than 20, and morbid patient. Morbid means within the 24 hours, the patient have a severe debility, some other severe what we call mortality, then you cannot give, don't give any activity. Once the patient will be stable spine and the increase intracranial less than intracranial pressure less than 20, then no morbid patient, then go for next stage we'll call one. That is the passive range of motion upright in the bed. If the passive range of the motion, your two patients should follow simple count, no any other spinal drain and extracranial ventricular drain, peritoneal chest, and no any other continuous VMS venous infiltration. Hemofiltration. If it is not that, you can then you start with a passive range of motion upright in the bed. Once next stage, if you see the patient, if you see the next day, bilateral quadriceps, I told you, know quadriceps strength is very important. 3x4 or more sits without support and non-weight bearing the restriction, then you can make the patient to sitting up. When the standing, what patient stand twice with the minimal assistance, steps in place, then you standing to progress to ambulating. This is for neurosurgery patients, you can apply this score, or any other general surgery patients, you can apply. All the patients you can use that, but it is more apt for the neurosurgery patients. Next is a Manchester mobility score. It is a less evidence than other scoring, but it is a, one is a bed intervention, two is a sit on the edge of the bed, three is a host to the chair, four is the standing practice, five the step transfer, six mobility, seven is mobilizing greater than 30 meter. If the patient you think they're more active, the ward patient, you can use this Manchester mobility score. Okay, next. This is the last part of this ICU scoring, PERMI ICU mobility score. What is PERMI? It is actually, this score is created by Cristiani PERMI, is a physiotherapist. She's developed this scoring. It is one of the excellent score, but it will take very long time. If the scores increases, your functional mobility will be improved. Patient decrease the ICU support, and patients weaning from the all the ICU support, decrease the length of stay. If score decrease with functional mobility decline, patient need ICU support, which may impact mobility. Next, you can see here, PERMI ICU mobility score, 15 items, it is 0 to 32, 7 category, mental status 3, that is ICU support which may impact mobility. ICU support means barriers, mobility barrier, you can term it as a mobility barrier, 4. Third is, 4 is bed mobility, and fifth one is, some message or transfer for 9 component, sixth one is, some messaging will be there, keep on. Sixth one is
no need to worry about the messages.
You it is hide whatever I am reading, sir. Sixth one is a gait with a walker 3 score. It is a 3 and endurance is 3. So total you calculate 32. 0 to 32, you can choose which is the least score to highest score. okay, this is, you can support everyone this skill because it is one of our physiotherapy only created the Permi, could be one of very relief, but it take time, it will take long time, usually more than extra 10 to 15 minutes will take for the this time. Next to next is actually, you see that mental status, it is consist of a lot for alertness upon the arrival. Second is the patient able to follow up 2 out of 3 commands. That is a mental status. It is actually about the mental status. Potential mobility barrier, I told you, ICU support, whether is the patient are mechanically ventilated, one, whether you have to scoring, that is I will explain the next slide. Next, second is the pain, one of the factor, pain one of the factor. And next is the patient has 2 or more of the following, whether the patient have any other CVP line or PA catheter or any other patient is on dialysis, anything you have to mention that which is affecting patient mobility, that's what is mobility barrier. Sixth is the patient on any trips, that is a fourth one. About the functional strength, legs, and make it a small Rupesh, I can't see the down one. Rupesh,
minimize the screen.
Okay, so here seventh is legs, the power of the legs, I told you, how the knee extension strength, like that. Eight also arms, that is also scoring. And next is the bed mobility, supine to stoot, and then the, and that is static sitting balance on edge of the bed. That is about the bed mobility, transfer sit to stand, standing transfer from the bed to chair. Last is gait, for the gait, number of that cadence, and the last is endurance, that is called 2 minutes test, that is the endurance which distance will calculate in the 2 minutes. It is, this is about the each component, I told you, total 7 components, each will be carry 0 to 32 marks, 32, the scoring will be 0 to 32. Next you go then. Next. Next you see this, can you make it big a little bit? So you see that now the mental status, maximum 3 points, alertness upon the arrival, unresponsive, lethargic, awake, 0 to 2. Is the patient able to 2 out of 3? Yes or no, 0 or 1. Potential barrier, I told you, with the patient are mechanically ventilated, yes or no. Pain, whether the patient have pain or no, yes or no pain. Same, similarly, the patient have any other following like endotracheal tube, IPP, intra, that is any other severe life supporting connection, then you can give yes or no. Like that, you have that scoring will be potential for mobility barrier. And loss of the functional strength, you have to see the maximum 0.4, legs or arms, you can use, yes, the whether the knee extension, flexion, or shoulder extension, flexion strength, you have to check with that. And the bed mobility, you can see that sixth one, bed mobility, supine to sit, whether you need a maximum assistance, moderate assistance, minimum assistance. Then static sitting balance on side and side of the bed, once the position is stopped, that is minimum, moderate, and maximum assistance, that is 0 to 3. Then transfer also sit to stand, and whether minimum to moderate, that is 0, 1, 2, 3, and like that, like the static standing balance and the transfer from bed to chair or chair to bed, like that, it is a minimum to maximum. And the gait component, the maximum point is 3. You can see the minimum to moderate, how much that patients is need a minimum or maximum support. Loss is endurance, distance walked in 2 minutes, regards of level of assistance required, rest of period, sitting or standing, with or without assistive device, that is how much distance, whether distance 5 to 50 or 51 to 100 or greater than 100, 0 to 3. So the maximum score is 0 to 32. You have to, because it is nigh, actually you, this is study you can use for your research practice. This is actually I taken from when I'm searching about my research practice, then I got this lot of articles supporting about the Permi score. Okay. So next slide, Rupesh. So you have now confusions, sir, which score I can use, sir? I don't know which score, sir, the physical function, I am getting confused. You are getting more confusion, don't confuse, because this is a one more study. I told you, it is done on 2017. Again, it is giving clear explanation, what scale you have to take according to that. What scale you have to take, which the patient, the about the patient according to the need of the patient. Whether you see that, first physical function measured using one of the following, that is CPX is Chelsea physical assessment score. FFIC, physical function status score, physical function ITU or ICU mobility, choice of instrument depends upon, if you are assessing only mobility, then you can use IMS, instrument mobility scale. If you are using strength plus mobility, then you can use physical function plus CELSIA assessment score. If you are assessing respiratory plus mobility, then CELSIA assessment score you can use. And detailed physical function evaluation, if you want a detailed physical function, FFSI, so I told you the first two, FFIC POFT is a high, very highly reliable for the detection of the discharge of the patient from the ICU. And last one, repeat evaluation at least weekly or ICU, you have to do every day. Every day you can do the patients, you check that it is not harmful, that you can do every day, you can check that. Next slide, Rupesh. So finally, I told you, I did that comparison. We had a study compared PFITU to FFICU, II Institute, instrument mobility scale, and short form of physical battery function, physical battery, the short form of physical battery. This is actually geriatric population. Some those who are risk of fall, they are using this SPPB. So what happened? Finally, that this study, see that 2015, they mentioned good validity between PFIT and all others. PFIT and FFICU, that is first and two, were more predictive of discharge to home. And IMS and SPP were not responsive for ICU. So PFITU and FFICU are promising functional measures and should be considered when measuring physical functions in the ICU. That's what two, I told you, first one and two, that is very important. But remaining other score also you have to analyze. That is, I made a lot of analysis with this study currently till the 2019, but in future we have to, again, we have to analyze once again the all physical function outcomes score. Next, Rupesh. So take home message for accurate mobility assessment, patient ICU therapist must clearly understand the consider severity of illness, changes the in functional status from baseline, risk of disability, standardized tests are not possible, specific tool assess the mobility for the patient in the ICU. Next. So thanks to this for your patience till now, because it is a big huge topic. Whenever sir given, I will be made to consist to, and a lot of element cut out, and even I want him, because outcome score, because here that a lot of students are there, I have to mention the PT role as well as outcome alone to take for long classes, but I will make cut down within 1.5-2 hours. 2 hours. I'm thankful for this many participants or that patients. Any queries, any doubts?
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, Shankar. We will ask the questions. There are some questions in the chat box.
Okay.
Rupesh?
Yes, sir.
Please read it.
I'll read it, sir. 1 second. So first question is from very long back, from Nishi Sangvi. Mm-hmm. Sir, prone position is difficult always with MV. Any other position to take to improve oxygenation?
Where is the questions? I can't see that. Which one?
Actually, she texted privately to me.
Okay, again, once again, prone position, how it's we difficult. Can do for difficult. The question is, see, I'm just giving small explanation. When I see one patient, since I have suspect the patient of COVID, but we are taking necessary precautions in the last week. But the patients are features of ARDS. Immediately, I advise the doctor, we did prone positioning. Because the patient, it is a severe acute form of respiratory distress. So what happened? There is no V by ventilation, perfusion, nothing will take place. The remaining area of the lung, you try to save and make the patient from that, because it is chances of most of the patients, see that the COVID issues, how many people are dying because of this symptoms will be the severe form, that is SARS-CoV, that is severe acute respiratory distress syndrome. Prone position only best, because surface anatomy, what, your lower lobe fully located in the posterior area, there is no option, you have to do the prone lying. It is done by only physiotherapist to take necessary. I told you have to take care of the airways and tubes, always keep in knowledge. First you can practice like that. Next question, anything that she maybe understand that. Next,
how does rotational therapy work for positioning, sir?
So I'm not master on it. Rotation therapy, it is basically an V by Q. I told you, after that ventilator patients, once we have to start it, there will be what the, because of the gravity, all secretion will settle down in their lower posterior vessels. So we actually think that patient secretion, it won't come from the periphery to central airways. We have to, that is why, what is partial drainage? Assumption of one or more gravity drive. You have to push the secretion from periphery to central. That is our duty to that. We have to do that, because in rotational, automatically you do that. Patients, each position you have to keep 20-20 for minutes, minimum 15 minutes. Automatically, because of the gravity, that viscosity, that the density of the secretion will be more. Automatically, because of the gravity, it's come to the central airways. Once the patient stimulated to the cough reflex, you have to aspirate the secretion from there. Next.
Next, what is the criteria for tracheostomy closure with from TPs?
Tracheostomy closure for the TPs, not what is the criteria for tracheostomy?
Closure. Criteria for tracheostomy closure from TPs.
Tracheostomy closures, you have to, I told you, ventilate depending, you started everything. First, we have to trial even, this is a nice question, what is even the tracheostomy closure before you can start with the spirometry. Which will be how I will made, no, it is actually old study, it is a 1960 studies. What, no, in the spirometry end, you have to take the 5 ml or 2 ml syringe, the nozzle you have to cut on the both end, and you attach with the spirometry, and you connect it to the fenestrate tube, or you remove the fenestrate tube, the tracheostomy, then you can start a spirometry to take a breath, one ball or two ball. Slowly the breathing, the patient, the respiratory muscle will strengthen. Slowly they will start to close with the stoma. Automatically you start to take the breathe on through the nose, whatever, the start with breathing. So once the criteria, what we call that, patient will start to normal breathing, because immediately tracheostomy you have to close and start, very difficult. But I used to tell the tracheostomy with that recently also on patients I practiced like that. Next.
Next is from Dr. Hiral. Sir, can you explain again regarding SOMS? All scoring examples score 0. If parameters are present, then it's grade 0. Later, we have to proceed to grade 2, which involves passive ROM.
I did once again.
I will unmute her, sir.
Okay.
Hiral, you can unmute and speak.
Can you go to that slide?
Yeah, sir. You can ask once again.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Yes, sir. Yes. No, Rupesh, is come to, you are going back. You are coming, friend. You're not going to back. You come. Yeah. Coming. Yeah, my ask the questions.
So like you said that in SOMS, grade 0 involves
next one.
SOMS 0 is no activity. The patient is completely inactive, right?
Yes.
The parameters which are given, like the stable spine, no spinal cord injury, these will be present in the patient, then it will be grade.
It should not present. Actually, that scale will give it like that. But actually, if you read that what I given the study, what, yes, are you got it? Yes, I'm audible.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
No, Rupesh, yes, go sir. To the next one. Rupesh, can you go to the next one? Next one, Rupesh. Ah, okay. Go back. Okay. So here you think that. Surgical optimization score, no activity means it is not meaning stable spine. If the patient does not have stable spine or having any other spinal cord injury, or if you know the patient intracranial pressure is great, or morbid patient, that is mortality within the 24 hours, it will be more. The patient, if we are mobilized, the patient chances of going to die or whatever, the severe problem, then you have to no activity. When if the stable spine for ICP is less or not a morbid, then you, that's what the it will see the arrow mark. You can see from that, it will be showing like that. If you read from that particular for journal, no, you can understand from that, you can go to for SOMS 0 to SOMS 1. Next, PROM, passive range of motion to operate, then you can see this, everything will be there. You can settle down, then you go to the next 2. Okay. Then like that, when the patient you are making standing, I told you, no, when you are make standing, you need a quadricep strength minimum 3. Otherwise, you cannot make standing. Patient will be what happened? Yeah. They will be sit collapse. Over the floor. Okay, not yeah. collapse. Will be
sit down.
The knee buckling will be there. So that's yeah. what you have to understand in that aspect. Ambulating finally tan twice and make to ambulate. Once the patient spot marching, tan twice, minimal assistance, step in the place. Then you can make to patient ambulating first with your support, slowly, independently, like that. You can start that.
Okay, sir.
Am I clear? You can use for
yes, sir.
Yes, you can use for neurosurgery situation more effective. Or surgical extubation also you can use it. Okay.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Next question is from Dr. Ravi Prakash. Which one is the most commonly used scale?
I told you that, no. Can you go previous slide, Rupesh? Because you are asking just commonly, but go back. Okay. Go back.
All scales will be there.
Yes. Good. Go back. One more. Yeah. So next one. Yeah. His first 1 and 2, I told you, highly reliable in that discussion. I told these 2 scores are very highly reliable for your physical outcome measures. Apart from that, that's what I mentioned that in the during ICU, according to your need, can you go to the last slide, end slide, Rupesh? End slide. Go previous one. So you see here, sir, this you see the during ICU, what according your need. For if you want mobility only, you can use IMS, strength and mobility, CPACS, respiratory and mobility. That is also critical Chelsea assessment score. If you want detailed physical function, I think this is a FFICU and PFITU is highly reliable than any other school in physical out. But in chest for component, you have to write oxygen gradient, everything you have to write in chest component, everything till if the auscultation also, till the chest clear, every day you have to auscultate and write whether normal vesicular blood sounds, air entry are equal or not. Like the chest outcome, everything you have to write, but physical outcome, you have to mention these 2 are very reliable than any other. Next, any other questions?
Yes, sir. Few appreciations, sir. From Vincent, sir. It's good presentation, Dr. Shankar, sir.
Thank you.
Next question is from Kaviarasi. Sir, what are all the criteria you follow for early mobilization?
The criteria I told in early mobilization, I see the monitoring system, all the monitoring systems, whenever the patient, if the patient with the ventilator, without ventilator, if the patient in the with the ventilator, I will see the FiO2 level, it is a 50 or 60, or if the patient having PEEP will be less than 10 or 7-8 like that. It is a standardized criteria you can make. Then you can make the out of bed chair sitting is safer. If the patient, even though the patient will be higher mode of support, what is the thing? No, if the patient have a higher mode of support, the patient need more oxygenation than any other. Patient first need adequate oxygenation, don't mobilize immediately to the patient. If the patient without mechanically ventilated, immediately I will start with the patient bedside all the exercise. I will slowly start with the high sitting, long sitting, standing and ambulating. That criteria before I see the vital, all the monitor vital, heart rate, respiratory rate, pulse rate, BP, everything I will check pre and post. According to that is your clinical decisions. Next to Rupi.
Sir, again, many appreciations. One from Anandi, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Next one from Annie, ma'am. Outcome measures explained very well. Thank you, sir. Again, many appreciations. Yes, sir. Next is from Sudhamati. Good evening, sir. Wonderful session. Can you tell why particularly metabolic acidosis is connected with the chest physiotherapy?
What you are asking, that is my research topic. I work on it and published one article. What is metabolic acidosis and chest physiotherapy? You know, it is a thing that kidney and lung crosstalk will be there. Whenever a patient have metabolic deficit, the compensation will going for the lung. So it is still now, there is no article or published related to the metabolic acidosis and chest, because already I done one observational study.
there is an interleukin, some other chemical mediator, which will be produced more secretion in the chest when the patient have chronic kidney disease. Chronic kidney disease will be there. That's why the patient have more. So this is called distance organ effect. Distance organ effect. ERD is one of the features for that. Distance ERD is not a lung disease. Actually, it is a distance organ effect. Because of the distance organ effect, it will develop this. Okay. Any other?
Yes, sir. Again, many appreciation from Ponmadi ma'am, Suresh Jyoti sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Suresh sir.
Again, from Kaviyarasi. How periodically should we use those outcome measures, sir?
That's what you have to use your comment, what I tell you, you have to use that your clinical decision. Every day I used to take the assessment. Till if suppose I'm taking PFITU, till the patients, if the patient in the ward itself, I can, some other patients, I will complete that whatever the score, 0 or 12, if the patient someone reaches 10 and 11, then immediately I will discontinue the patients. See, I told you, know, whenever patient shifting to the ward, immediately you should not discontinue. What is the criteria for your discontinuing the patients? Then you have to make the patient sure what are the important the criteria, whether you have to, what outcomes you are measuring, because the outcome measures only the telling whether you want to discontinue or not. If the physical outcome function is everything fine, then you can discontinue. Don't put for more burden to the patients. That is every routine you can practice, then only you can develop which is reliable. I used to PFITU, FFICU and Chelsea assessment score. I'm using for other routine practice. Next.
Yes, sir. Again, from Kaviyarasi, what precautions should be taken when patients with inotropic support, and what is influence with physical therapy treatment?
No, inotropic support, first you think that when the patient will be inotropic support, nothing but what is inotropic, increase the myocardial contractility. If suppose the patient have high inotropic support, if you start to mobilize, what happen? It giving stress over your heart. Again, what happen? Your inotrope is given mainly for your patient should relax, your heart should be pumped normally. If inotrope support slowly, they're weaning. If they 10 to 0.1 1 ml are weaning, then you can start your, because if the patient with the higher support, you are giving stress to your heart. Again, what happened? Again, you have to increase the inotropic support. Chances of the what happened, the patients will be going for hypotension also will be there. So inotropic suppression increase the what we call that is increase the myocardial contractility. Some other inotropes will be the dobutamine, same as increase the myocardial contractility and increase the, for urine output. So like that patient, you can make sitting and standing, and you can try that with the, around the cot, you can do that. Whether see the pre and post vitals, you can see that if the patient suddenly the chances to collapse. So we have to be careful with this type of patients. Any other?
Sir, now Vincent sir wants to speak to you, sir. Sir, okay. You can
connect there.
Yes, sir.
Sir, good evening, Shankar, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Sir, wonderful presentation. Nice to hear your voice in this kind of media after a long time.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. So, my concern is, sir, so you have spoke n number of this assessment thing, okay?
For outcome measures.
Yeah, outcome measure. First day in ICU, what you will do if the patient having a ventilator, sir? Many students are there here, so it will be very good for them.
Actually, it is a good question, sir. What are the, whenever patient I'm seeing the ventilator, I will see the patient what type of primary problem, whether have the patients are primary problem or stabilized. If the patient primary problem is not stabilized, we should not start immediately to the physiotherapy. If the patient primary problem is stabilized, but after the 2 days also you are not started the physiotherapy, then it is a problem. That's what is the primary problem they should stabilize, as well as I told you, sir, critical illness polyneuropathy, that is ICU acquired weakness. Acquired means because of the, you are missing that particular patients for the physical therapy, the patient for develop for deconditioning. So immediately I start to assess that whatever the scoring system, sedation, whatever scoring system, I will work on them immediately. I will do the passive movements and I will start it. Everyday routine, that scoring Chelsea, for Chelsea scoring, it is giving grade 0, I can do just a passive movement. Slowly it is going to 1, 2, 3, 4, then according to that, I will patient progressive ambulation, I will do that, sir. It is okay. Your clinical decision, sir, it is upon your clinical decision. If the patient is not stabilized, then how you can give, you are again putting burden to the patients. So that is one important thing. That mostly within a 24 hours, you can give the rest. Within a 24 hours that you have to start the physiotherapy once the patient has stabilized.
Okay, sir. If a student's entering an ICU, suddenly they are hearing some buzzing sound, different kind of horn sound will be there, indicator sound. So what is the first thing the student-wise they want to note that, sir? So if some alarm is coming,
whenever I will offer my PG, I enter that, I will go to use to silent the alarm, but I won't see what is the alarm is giving. Because whenever the student hears the sound, we have to hear what is the alarm sounds only. Whenever the for alarm sound, you are seeing what is the problem of the whether the problem in the ventilator or patients are monitoring. You have to check that. If suppose the patient's tube working or patient when he ventilator tube maybe get blocked, the patient not adequate oxygenation, not receiving the adequate oxygenation, then immediately you want to work on it. You should not go to immediately silent and do your routine again the same activity. You should, what is that you have to sort out, suppose increase a minute ventilation, the indication patient started to increase more amount of secretions and coughing will be more, so you have to immediately do the CES physiotherapy and as well as either aspirate the secretions from the tracheobronchial tree. That is a thing you have to do. That you have to interpret and implement what you are interpret from that immediately you are think and do it, sir.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir.
The next Suresh Jyoti sir wants to speak, sir.
Okay, sir.
Sir, you can unmute, sir.
Yes, good evening. Thank you, Shankar Ganesh, for giving wonderful presentation.
Thank you, sir.
You have mentioned scales which is used in ICU. Any other scales particularly available for neurological conditions? That's like traumatic brain injury?
Sir, I used
spinal cord injury.
Yes, sir. Spinal cord injury. That's what I told him, sir. So, surgical ICU optimization mobilization scale, sir. It is made only by the neurosurgery patients. Most of the studies have done, sir. Same, even I told the pumpless protocol. Have you seen the pumpless protocol? There also a lot of studies mentioned this Soames protocol, sir. For a neurosurgery ICU patient, because all other patient neurosurgery ICU patient took special concern because the head end elevations and the intracranial pressure should not build up. That is something you have to concern about. That that's what the scale will be made at. If the patient everything in the drains, everything that is for extracranial drains all are removed, then you can slowly start our ambulation for ambulation according to the Soames grading, sir.
I want you to explain what difference in neurological ICU as well as the other ICU. I know how much extensive experience you'll be having in neurological ICU. Can you please explain to the students what difference in neurological ICU as well as other cardiological ICU?
Okay, it is actually what that even you are asking the question is a very good question, sir. So whenever I'm going, because I was working in the surgical ICU, most of the neurosurgery ICU patients will come. So neurosurgery ICU patient, first I will always, patients will be in ICU, they will for the airway clearance, where the patient the mechanically ventilated airway clearance, we all work on it mainly the chest part. Till immediately that once the patient, if the patient will be hemorrhagic or ischemic, two types of that, hemorrhagic stroke, I will wait for minimum 1 or 2 days, because the patients, if they should not feel comfortable, the what we call that the patient should not again move to more the hemorrhagic, whatever, it should not far affect the patient. So we will wait 1 or 2. For ischemic stroke, we will clear from the physician. Then we will start and do the patient strolling from side lying, and that is for left side lying, right side lying. Then make the sitting, and if the second day onwards, they will remove the drain from the epi for extracranial drains. And for immediately, I will start to do, even I can say the bed set itself, I will start to make the patient will be little bit higher sitting and make the standing also, sir. From that slowly I will make on it. Apart from that, patients will be, I used to assess this scale, everything will be there. And suppose the patient having right hemiplegia, for neurosurgery cases are RTA. So RTA patient for first few days will be that what we call the patients will be hemiplegic side. We have to take the positioning and necessary precaution will be there. Once the patients will be to 28 to 48 hours, we started for the passive movement slowly according to the patient's needs, sir. We'll do that, sir.
Thank you, sir. And I'm happy sir. To have you on in this webinar session. After a long time, I'll be seeing in your public platform presentation. Thank you, sir.
Sir, Suresh Jyoti, sir, please wait. I think we have Annie Madam also. Annie Madam?
Hello? Annie Madam?
Yes, madam.
Yes, ma'am. Unmute. Yeah, unmute, ma'am.
She is in a neuro specialist, no?
Specialist.
So she wants to add some points, actually.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Madam, unmute Annie, madam.
Yeah, unmuted. Ma'am, you can speak, ma'am.
Ma'am, are you there? Ma'am, can you hear us?
Hello.
Any ma'am, can you hear us?
It's not audible, I think.
Sir, ma'am is on video.
Go for next question.
Sir, ma'am is on video.
We will go for next question, Rupesh.
Sir, ma'am is asking something in the video. We cannot hear you, ma'am.
Yeah. We will go for next question.
Okay. Yes, sir. From Kaviarsi again. Is there any influence of ventilator modes on chest physio, sir?
Definitely. That is our main. We are work on that chest physiotherapy mainly to weaning from the ventilator. She asking the question. Any? What is the relation between weaning from that? Remote of the ventilator from the chest physiotherapy. Yes.
She has just asked. You can unmute Kaviarasi. Is there any influence of ventilator modes on chest physiotherapy? Just,
can you unmute and better? I think.
Yeah. Kaviarasi, you can speak.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
It's a nice presentation, sir.
Thank you.
So my question is, what is the influence of the ventilator mode on physio? So might be the patient will be on SIM or CMV.
Okay. No, as I previously I mentioned, patient, if the patient will be in the conscious on the mechanical ventilator, you are giving active chest physiotherapy. Active chest physiotherapy, it is by means of how it will be, whether you can tell the patient will be, you are giving airway clearance, right and left side lying, chest PT, you can giving aspirate the secretion. And same, you are doing positioning lung volume, that is increase the lung volume. And second thing, you teach the patient how to wean from the, that is teach the breathing exercise along with the ventilator. If the patient in the assist control or patient in the CPAP or any other mode, what you are talking for SMB also, you can take the patient along with the ventilator, patient also initiate the breath, then only what happened, it is easy to weaning from the ventilator and is as well as improve the oxygenation parameter. If then patient reduce the length of ventilator support, if it will reduce the length of the ventilator support, when you, what you are talking that assist control SME mode. I think you got it.
Yes. Sir.
Any other queries?
Vincent sir, you can. Vincent sir.
Sir, it's audible, sir. Shankar sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, as you are a cardio related physiotherapist, I want to ask one question, sir. It's not related to today's topic, but as yes, a cardio therapist, sir. So recently, in this past 2 or 3 months, I have heard almost some 13 people, they have a silent cardiac arrest, sir. In this 2 months gap itself, their age is almost below 45.
Okay, sir.
So, as a cardio physiotherapist, what is your message or some suggestion you want to give to the society, sir?
Sir, actually, I tried to answer. Maybe it will be satisfy your questions. See, yes, this is actually 25% of cardiac death because of this silent chest. Because it is the patient, if they having any other peripheral, what we call it, the patient have a diabetes mellitus. Most of the patient will be the diabetes mellitus, or they have a loss of the sensation, thermal sensation. So even they don't know the patients. We even see the. Everyone thinking I got a chest pain. Chest pain, one of the beautiful thing for the patient, at least getting there because of some other organ systems are involving it is giving any alarms about the particular patient. If the patient getting chest pain, it is a good. Some other patient, even the patient have a severe one vessel, two multiple vessel block, even they not get the patient because of the diabetes mellitus, because 25% of cardiac death because of this silent chest, because they don't know the thermal sensation. the thermal sensation, even they told even the one of the contraindication PA shoulder, we are giving wax therapy if the patient does not have a thermal sensations. So like that, it is also one of the reasons, but we cannot find out, because once the age will be the cross the 35 to 40, you can do the routine master checkup. Then only we can find out these things. Apart from that, any other suggestion, they can put it on your comment to the box for the SAR question. This is my from my
okay,
side.
Okay, sir. Because past this, in between this 2 month itself, we have heard almost known people. Actually, these are all 13 people.
So this is a young cardiac death or what, sir?
Yes, sir. Younger. The age is in between 45. Below 45.
No, sir. Because what is the things? No, because nowadays there will be all the what we call lifestyle modifications. The problem, sir. So how many people are doing routine everyday routine daily activities, sir? Because last class will be Bhaskar sir. I'm taking for the last class 2 weeks.
Okay, there. Okay.
He's
sir.
Mentioned about very clearly about what our lifestyle habits it will be affect our heart. And even now or sometimes because of our sedentary lifestyle, sir, because we are because nowadays we are using before we are for you it will be we used to walk in the wherever you are, no, we are going to the school or wherever you used to walk. Nowadays we have that motorbike, so wherever if you go to buy the milk packet also, we are not physically active, we are using that available transport like this. So it is reduce our physical capacity, sir. So that is the main reason. And patient nowadays everyone have that smoking, alcohol, one of the reason, and they not care about that particular for themselves. That is the main reason for my I'm thinking, sir.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Annie ma'am wants to speak, sir.
Okay.
Actually, there are two Annie, madam. One is Dr. Annie Thomas and another one is Annie Linda. I request Annie Thomas, please unmute.
Okay, Annie ma'am also has asked to unmute.
Yeah.
Yeah, ma'am, you can.
She was trying, actually, Dr. Annie Thomas is trying for a long time.
Yes.
Madam, are you there?
Yeah, you can speak, ma'am.
Annie madam was responding in our YouTube channel, actually. I don't find her here.
Okay. What was her question?
Question was she wants to ask him directly.
Okay, now we will connect Annie Linda. By the time I will send her the link and password. Annie Linda?
Sir. Please unmute Annie.
Yeah, unmute.
Annie madam. Annie ma'am, you can speak now.
No, she is muting herself, ma'am.
So there is a question in YouTube.
Yes.
You can paste it here or you can ask.
Yeah, I am pasting it to Rupesh.
Yes, yes.
Can you see the question, Rupesh?
Yeah. Is the criteria same for all type of patients like cardiopulmonary patient, gastrosurgical patient, neuro patient?
Yes, this is, I told you, know, this is a, in ICU, it is a very vague, and what you have to do that decisions. See, if surgical patients, you have to use according to the patient need what type of, I told you, auscultate, whether the patient need lung volumes or airway clearance or the patient need exercise and gravity test. What that your decision you have to do. Most of the surgical patient, what happened, post-operative atelectasis, immediately work on the patient will be lung volume, lung expansion therapy, as well as if suppose you take that, suppose you are telling any other abdominal surgery, what happened, the patient have complaint of pain, you have to start with the patient, because of the pain the patient's chest also getting bad, maybe the post-operative pulmonary complication, you have to work on that, giving incentive spirometry, and if the patient is possible, you can make, I told you, getting out of bed, out of bed, that is one of the best tool I'm using there. All the patients surgery will make that, when you make the patient exercise and gravity stress, automatically the patient lung is getting expand.
Yes,
from myself, this is my question, my answer.
Yes, what are your criteria for weaning of a patient, sir?
Weaning of the patients are criteria. I told you now, PaO2 by FiO2, oxygenous index, PaO2 divided by FiO2. I think it is will be greater than 300. It should be greater than 300, and it should be at least greater than 250. It is one of the criteria, as well as AA gradient. Multiple factors will be, we cannot say the weaning criteria, because our role, one of the important role is there, that because from the gradual weaning, gradual reduction from the ventilator support, you have to see that minute ventilation, muscle strength, maximum voluntary, maximum MV, maximum voluntary ventilations. So multiple factors are there. You have to see that factors. From that, after only you can do that, patients will be slowly weaning from. If the one factor is not so, then you have to, if the patient PaO2 by FiO2 oxygen index greater than lesser than 200, then you should not extubate the patient. Patient, you cannot extubate means patient will be need some oxygenation support. So you if you extubate also with necessary precaution, patient need high flow oxygen therapy, like that only slowly you can go for the weaning. Because the patient intubation only you can wait for 1-2, according to our textbook, is 7 days. Sometimes it's going for 9 days. After that, we do the tracheostomy. Or before that, you try to make the patients to weaning from the ventilator. Any other?
No, sir. All questions are answered. Yes, sir.
I just, can you hear me? I'm sorry.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Ganesh has done a good job.
Thank you, ma'am.
Nice. I heard only half through, but whatever information you provided is good. I just, somebody asked about Noor also. I thought I'll put a point regarding that.
Yes, ma'am. They're asking questions about how you differentiate from the neurosurgery ICU to other ICU protocol, ma'am. That's what I mentioned, the pumpless protocol, one component I mentioned. That is
one thing. And another thing, what we have to do in neuro ICU is especially two different categories of neuro patients. One is regarding the head injury or stroke patients. We can categorize into one. Another one is the spinal cord injury and GBS patients. So transesophageal, this kind of conditions, especially with the spinal, cerebellar, or the down, that is it. But when you see about the ICU patients, either in the traumatic brain injury or stroke, the main thing we have to go about is GCS, of course, we have to see the things. Then intracranial pressure is the first and foremost thing, they have to watch it out. If the ICU is not having an intracranial pressure monitor, then you have to see the systolic pressure. And the systolic pressure, they have to see when they do mobilization or chest PT, how much the BP fluctuation is happening. If the fluctuation is more than 20 mm of HG, they are not supposed to give any agitation kind of exercises. You should give exercises in a relaxed mode, and you should not give clapping directly on the chest. That is also one thing you have to do. So intracranial pressure is one of the most things. If you think of the outcome measures, agitation scale can do it in ICU, especially stroke or the traumatic brain injury patients. They'll be agitated and they will not be willing for any kind of treatment. So that part they have to see. Agitation scale, they can use it, and RLS scaling, they can use it for the PT management in ICU. That two things we can take care. If you see the spinal cord injury patients, or if the patient is GBS, then the proper protocol of mobility program, we have to especially see, again, the BP, especially the systolic pressure, should not go below 100, and the SpO2 should never go beyond 80%. These two things additionally should see with the other ventilatory monitors, whatever you have. If at all, if the patient is on ventilatory support and if using FiO2 and PEEP also, in the ventilator itself, it should not vary more than, SpO2 should not go below 80, or BP thing, systolic should never go beyond 20 mm of HG. With their resting pressure, whatever you are checking, that two things has to be very careful in thing, and should not, chest PT especially, should not keep the head down, because that will again create issues in the ICP, especially in the patients with stroke and bleeding, and if the patients with the traumatic brain injury, because diffused injuries will not show a bleeding much, but the intracranial pressure might have been increased because of the ventricular pressure, which is more amount of ICF fluid in that. So that two things I just thought of adding into that. GBS, the issue is with diaphragmatic paralysis. And if it has gone to bulbar area, your respiratory center and your cardiac center is affected. So that part also, when you prop up or when you mobilize or when you give chest PT, that things should be cleared. When you say of outcome measures, I said agitation scale or RLS scoring, you can do it, and plus whatever chest monitoring outcome scales you are using, that you can do it. Thank you so much. That much will I know. The other things I think Ganesh has already provided you much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you so much, madam. Hope Suresh Jyoti sir, you got your point.
Okay, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am, and thank you, Shankar Ganesh.
Thank you, Suresh. Thank you.
Another one more, Annie Linda. Does she have any question? She was asking, I think. Upesh?
Yes, they're in the meeting, I think. I don't find her name in the list.
Is she there, Annie Linda?
No, sir. She's not there in the list.
Okay. Now, any other questions?
No, sir, not left, sir. Everything is answered.
Is Dr. Revati there?
Yes, sir.
Ask
her. I'll unmute.
Yeah.
You can unmute, Revati.
Hello?
Yes, Revati. So, yes, tell me.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening. Yes.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the very detailed explained class. After a long time hearing your class, sir. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
It's my privilege to be with you all to propose vote of thanks to those who have directly and indirectly contributed to this topic, physiotherapy role and outcome measures in ICU. I extend a very hearty vote of thanks to the resource person who blessed with us with their presence and took out valuable time of your busy schedule.
Yes.
I must mention our deep Thank sense you. Of appreciation to Dr. Shankar Ganesh sir for his work. Thank you, sir. Thank you for enlightening the role of decision making in ICU and the important treatment sessions in ICU. Thank you for the detailed explanation of the ICU outcomes of pulmonary outcomes, physical function outcomes. It was really a very interactive session, sir. Very detailed explanation, more informative session, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
As no program can be successful with a single person, so I extend my vote of thanks to Dr. Chandramohan, Sri Samraj Physiotherapy Center, Dindivanam, Dr. Rupesh, Peak Health Studio, Chennai, Professor Tuna Saha, West Bengal, Dr. Arnacharam, Sairam Academy, Dr. Manoj, Physioactive Gurugram, exrxindia.org, Fitness and Rehab India YouTube channel. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much for the opportunity, sir. Once again, thank you for the whole team for the still that whatever I made a small mistake also that for your patience. And thank you, sir. Chandramohan, sir. Thank you a lot.
Thank you. Really, it is a very lengthy session we ever had, actually. It is almost 150 minutes. I thank you very much for all the effort you have done.
Yes, it's
and
yes,
I thank
sir.
All the participants who patiently waited till the end. And really nice session. I thank EXRX team members, Dr. Rupesh and Professor Duna, and all other professors, my professors, who took part in this. So thank you all. Good night.
Thank you, sir. Good night, sir.
Thank you, Rupesh. Thank you, Duna, ma'am. Thank you all. Thank you.
Good night.
Thank you, sir.